Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to my YouTube channel. My name is John Campia, and this is a special stream that we're doing here today. By the way, hello to everybody in the live chat who's already here. Hello, everybody. I hope you all can see and hear me okay. This is a little bit of a different event today. Of course, today is the Disney Investors Streaming Day, where we are expected to hear an awful lot of announcements, an awful lot of not just announcements about Star Wars, about MCU, about Pixar and Disney proper. We're also going to be hearing a lot about Disney's future plans for Disney Plus. What is their overall philosophy going to be? Now, listen, we're going to do a live watch along here. We are going to be doing a live watch along, as you can see the stuff that we've got going on here. This is the event right now as it's being played out. You can see that right here. And we're going to be watching this together, and I'll be reacting to it as we go. Now, this is going to be long. And they're saying 4 hours. I don't think we're going to need to go the full four hours. I think they'll get some of the stuff, some of the more important stuff done in the first half. What am I expecting? I am expecting a number of things. Like I said, I think we're going to get major announcements about Star Wars. I think we're going to get some solidifying stuff about the new female-centric Star Wars show that they're saying happens in a different part of the universe. We're going to find out what that means, I think. I think they're going to give us some updated information on Obi-Wan. I believe they're going to be announcing an Ahsoka Tano spinoff. We'll find that out. As far as the MCU goes, a lot of different things going on. I think we're going to get some timeline stuff figured out. I think we're going to find see some shuffling. Now, by the way, I said a while ago that I don't know for sure if they're going to be putting Black Widow straight to Disney Plus. I said I don't know, but I said I believe they will. And there are some reports that have come out in the last 24 hours that with some trades saying that it's looking like Disney isn't going to put Black Widow straight to streaming. I still believe they will. I don't know that they will. There's a difference between what we know and what we believe. I still believe that today they are going to announce that Black Widow is moving over to Disney Plus. I believe that's what's happening. By the way, guys, so since today's a little bit different, we're going to take Super Chats today. If you want to send in a Super Chat, you got something you want to say or ask, we're going to be using Super Chats today for those of you watching in the live YouTube stream. We already got one from Marsh Life, who wrote in over under 8% that Sony makes Amazing Spider-Man 3. Would you want to see it and finally get answered to the mystery of his parents? Hey, listen, I would have really liked to have seen the Amazing Spider-Man 3 because I like the Andrew Garfield iteration of Spider-Man. I really do. Even though The Amazing Spider-Man 2 wasn't all that great, certainly didn't live up to the first one. I thought the first Amazing Spider-Man was wonderful. But no, I don't think they're going to go back and make The Amazing Spider-Man 3. I don't think that's going to happen. And hello to everybody in the chat. There's already like over about 3,500 of us in here waiting for this thing to start. And I'll crack on the audio once. What are they playing there right now, by the way? They were playing some great movie tunes. Too bad. They were just rocking out some Phil Collins from Tarzan. I freaking love that soundtrack, Phil Collins to start. Now, listen, be aware of this, too. And I mentioned this a little earlier, but it really should be thing. This isn't going to be like 3 hours of, you know, groundbreaking, earth-shaking announcement one after the other. There's going to be, for a lot of people in this stream, a lot of what I would call, you know, boring stuff. A lot of boring stuff. A lot of boring business stuff. Now, to me, I love the boring business stuff. I think the business stuff is fascinating, and I'm looking forward to hearing that crap, too. But just be aware, there's going to be some big announcements, but there's also going to be a lot of business things that me and some of you guys are going to eat up, and some of you guys may find that kind of tedious and boring. But just be aware that that's going to be a part of it. Hey, Insomniac writes in, hey, from Ottawa. I love Ottawa. Thanks for everything you do, bro. Shout out to everyone in the chat. Thanks for shouting out to everyone, Insomniac. Christian Tejeda just sends in a super chat. Thank you, Christian. Darth Wayne is writing in. Star Wars live action series set in the High Republic era announcement. Listen, they've got a lot. We saw from that behind the scenes video a number of months ago, they've got a lot planned for the High Republic era. So I would not doubt at all, Darth Wayne, that we're going to get an announcement today about how I don't know that they are. I haven't heard anything about them, but I would not doubt in the least. I wouldn't find it unbelievable at all that they announce a High Republic series. Not at all. Aaron Moen writes, You think we'll hear more about the Nick Fury series? Yes. They announced a Nick Fury series ages ago, right? Ages ago, they announced that they were going to be doing Nick Fury. We haven't heard anything since. I suspect we will get some follow-up and some clarification. Sorry, I had almonds earlier, and I still have little almond chunks in my throat. Ah! Okay, so I do expect, as I still fight with this almond flake that's in my damn throat, I do expect we will hear something regarding the Nick Fury thing. Yes, Zeke is writing in, do you think Disney will still make movies for the theaters, or will they drop the theaters completely? That's where they're heading, but I do believe they are going to extend like an olive branch to theaters in this thing. I think we are going to hear about a number of films still playing in theaters. I still don't think Black Widow will be one of them, but we'll find out for sure in a little bit here. But yeah, I do believe one of the announcements will be announcing certain films that are going to stay in theaters. Iconic Reactions, we just got a couple more minutes, guys, till this event starts. Iconic Reactions writes in, hey man, would you ever let me interview you for a school project? Probably not. I appreciate you asking, Iconic, but I get asked to do interviews and stuff like that. I get like three or four requests a day. I generally don't do them. I'm just too busy. And I'm not interesting anyway. Trust me, I wouldn't add anything to your project. Jake Walsh is writing, do you care to see the Cassian Andor show? I do. I was personally not a big fan of Rogue One. Oh, I love Rogue One. And while I'm sure the show will be fine, I want to see new characters and new stories. Also love the documentary. Thank you so much, Jake. Jake's talking about my documentary that is available now. Movie Trailers, A Love Story. You can go and find it and watch it. I love Rogue One, and to find out the seed, like, you can't have a rebellion without having some seedier underside to things. And hold a second, guys, I think they're getting ready here. Let's find out here. I think they're getting ready to start here. But anyway, as far as the Cassian Andor thing goes, I am very much looking forward to that. I think it could be looking, like I said, you can't have a rebellion without having some people getting their hands dirty. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm curious to see that in Cassian Andor. So I think they're going to go that way with it. Let's see here. Thanks for that, Jake. Appreciate that. Eric Thorpe writes, any chance Famke Janssen will return as Xena on a top? I love that. I know she technically died, but if Darth Maul can get cut in half, etc. I don't think there is. I don't think there is. I'm still wondering if maybe Kevin Feige, if they're going to bring back Andrew Garfield and Jamie Foxx, I wonder if Kevin Feige would consider bringing back Famke Janssen to do, you know, to be in X-Men. I'm just saying there, her back as Jean would be interesting. Jaron Morris is right. In theory, John, I'm super excited for God of War 2 coming soon, but hear me out. Ragnarok is the end of the gods. What if Ragnarok is Kratos? It's possible. But listen, I want to focus more here on the Disney stuff that we're talking about here today. I want us to focus. They're still doing a countdown. They're going to be starting the presentation here in just a moment. But it's possible they could incorporate those mythologies with God of War 2. The first God of War game was amazing. The story's absolutely fantastic. Matthew Stockenberger writes, in the past hour, Marvel unlocked Twitter accounts for Eternals, Shang-Chi, Hawkeye, Ms. Marvel, and added a Secret Invasion account. Hot damn! Hot damn! I'm telling you stuff. Guys, we're going to get some big stuff announced today. We are going to get some big, big stuff announced today. And I think that, Matthew, was just a harbinger of the things to come. Thanks for sharing that, man. Joseph Book Reviews writes, think we'll learn more about Kenobi? I absolutely do. I'll put it this way. I'll be shocked if we don't find out more about Kenobi. Absolutely shocked if we don't find out. Oh, they just put up a 5-minute countdown clock. So we've got 5 minutes here. Until we start, let me keep ripping through some of these questions you guys are sending in. Xbox writes in, I'm expecting trailers for Loki. Maybe. What if? But I don't expect trailers. Remember, this is an investor's call. They're going to communicate information. If they do show a trailer, great. If they do show footage, great. I'm not expecting trailers or footage. But wouldn't it be a delightful surprise? What if WandaVision, Black Widow, Spider-Man 3, Eternal, Shang-Chi, Thor, Love and Thunder? Again, I'm not expecting that. But if it comes and they do it, fabulous. I think we should be more prepared for information that's coming, but we'll find out soon enough. Arthur writes, personally, I don't want a High Republic show. It's been a while since us book and comic fans got something for ourselves, you know? Yeah, but the reality is, Listen, I read all the Legends stuff too, and the X-Wing stuff, Rogue Squadron, and I read all the stuff too. But really, we are the minority. It seems pretty clear they are going to be heading into High Republic, something brand new. And I got to tell you, as somebody who complains a lot that Star Wars doesn't do enough that's brand new, to me that's kind of exciting. Ben Rayner's writing, over under 10%, John and Dave are put in charge of Lucasfilm Creative today, under 10%. I do believe Dave Filoni is not prepared to be a studio executive. He's just not yet. He may get there someday. He's not even a full-fledged live-action director yet, but he's getting there. Man, he's been getting better. Jon Favreau soon, but I don't think they're announcing that today. Kathleen Kennedy is going to be gone, I think, within the year, but I don't think it's going to be today. Pandy writes, Spider-Man 3 news today? Absolutely, I believe so. I absolutely believe we're going to get Spider-Man 3 news today. I really do. I mean, who knows? Anything can happen. We're at 3 minutes, guys. Nicholas Stanley writes, can you see Sony buying Hulu from Disney? No. But Sony did just buy Crunchyroll. They already have Crackle. They just bought Crunchyroll. They are trying to move on things. But Disney just paid a lot of money to make sure they had a majority ownership in Hulu. I don't think they're looking to sell it. They may fold it into something else, but I don't think they're looking to sell it. Genevieve writes, hello from Ireland. Hello, Genevieve from Ireland. Already 21:30 here, and I have a class for my IT master's tomorrow morning. Hopefully this won't be too late. Love the show. Thank you so much, Genevieve. Yeah, and listen, it's going to be 4 hours long. I'm not going to go for the full 4 hours because, like I said, I think they're going to get a lot of the big stuff done fairly close to off the top. So I don't think we're going to have to wait too long to get any things. Max Papineau is writing in. Hey, John, greetings from Stratford, Ontario. I've been to Stratford many times. So totally hypothetical here, but since it appears that Sony is bringing back some of their former Spider-Man villains out of these left, who would you like to see? And then I don't have it. Sorry, we'll try to get to that, Max, when we get around 2 minutes left here, guys. Peter Cunning writes, hope Black Widow plays in theaters and at home. That is a possibility. That is definitely a possibility. Dada writes, John, what do you think of the title Spider-Man, Me and the Homies? It has home in it. Hey, as long as it's got home in it, Dada, it's got a total potential. I obviously wouldn't go for it, but Me and the Homies, why not? Official Friend Zone, I love that name, writes, over under 45%, we hear about Spider-Man 3 rumor confirmation. I believe we're going to hear some of them will be confirmed, some of them won't be, but I do believe we're going to get a more solid idea stuff going on with Spider-Man 3. Definitely find out about the Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield stuff. Jose Josie Reviews writes, think we'll get our new Black Panther? Maybe. I'd give it a 10% chance they announce who the new Black Panther is today. 10% chance. 90% chance that they don't, but there is a possibility there, Josie. That would bust the internet if they did. James Colon writes, just sends in super chat. Thank you, James. Doug Smith, Spider-Man 3 cost confirmations or no because of Sony? I believe we will. I believe we will get some confirmations today. Jamil Odin writes, thoughts on Netflix expansion in New Mexico? Again, I want to focus more on Disney stuff here today, but I didn't know Netflix was doing an expansion in New Mexico, so that's new to me. I'll look into that a little bit later. Ryan Cleary writes, I heard confirmation of Matt Murdock in Spider-Man 3. BS, there is no confirmation. Just be clear, there is no confirmation on that. As of right now, that is still a rumor. Maybe they say something about it today, but as of right now, it's still just a rumor. Max Papner writes, the Green Goblin, Sandman, Venom, the Lizard, and Rhino. Thanks to keep up the filthy Goblin. Goblin is the one I'm most interested in. But remember, Venom, if they bring Venom in, it's going to be Tom Hardy's Venom. It's going to be Tom Hardy's Venom that they do this. All right, guys, we will get back to live questions that you guys have been sending in more just a little bit later. But for now, let's kind of tune in and see what is going on here. All right, they said they're starting.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm Walt Singer, Senior Vice President of Investor Relations at the Walt Disney Company.
By the way, guys, let me know if you can hear it okay.
To welcome you to Disney Investor Day 2020.
All right.
We truly appreciate you taking the time to join us here today.
You are a boring looking man.
Investor Day, we intend to
only slightly less boring looking than me
about our direct to consumer opportunity, and also to answer many of the questions you've asked us.
Yes.
Our first direct-to-consumer investor day in April.
So they're going to be talking a lot about Disney Plus.
So let me provide some details for the day. In a moment, you will hear from Bob Chapek, Disney's chief executive officer.
He's the guy who just replaced Iger.
Kareem Daniel, who heads our media and entertainment distribution business, will discuss our commercialization strategy. Ooh, you will then hear more important detail about our direct-to-consumer businesses, including Disney Plus, Star, Hulu, and ESPN Plus.
Oh, they are going to talk about Hulu. Good. I was wondering about that. Break.
And following the break, our executive chairman, Bob Iger, will kick off a presentation of our incredible content pipeline, during which you will hear from many of our company's amazing creative executives. Later, our chief financial officer, Christine McCarthy, will provide a financial update. And then after Bob Chapek wraps up the day, we will move to an analyst question and answer session. We are joining you today from stage two here on our lot in Burbank.
It sounds
the same stage.
They're going to be doing what's going on with Disney Plus, Hulu, ESPN right up front, and then they're going to get into content. So that's what it sounds like right now.
Consumer ambition. Some things haven't changed at all, including our legal team. So before we move on, I must mention that statements made in today's presentation may contain forward-looking information. Actual results may differ.
Look at the size of this disclaimer they're putting in there. Oh my God. Who's supposed to be able to read that?
Identifies and gives you details about some of the risks regarding those forward-looking statements, as well as where to go.
Business jargon. I get they got to cover their asses. I get that.
Now, a couple of logistical notes about today.
Okay.
Due to some rights issues, we will only be able to stream some of the videos that we are showing today. We apologize that we can't share all of them. However,
we
have a lot we can show you. And we also hope that you can view today's presentation on a large screen. Shortly after the conclusion of today's presentation, we will be making a replay of the event available. We will also be posting downloadable slides to our website.
Okay, guys, I've made the volume on as pretty much as loud as I can.
Importantly, thanks for taking the time to join us today. And now it is my pleasure to introduce the Chief Executive Officer of the Walt Disney Company,
Bob Chapek. So this is the guy who, remember, Bob Iger was the CEO. Bob Iger is still the head guy at Disney. But Bob Chapek is now the new CEO.
I wish we could be together for this. I think you'll find the presentation we have for you is truly spectacular.
It's like they're trying to do a bit of an Apple thing.
It's only been a year since we first introduced you and the world to a whole new way of enjoying the magic of Disney and the company.
Here we go, talking about Disney Plus. I think they're about to lay out the future of this company.
Service featuring content only Disney can create would resonate with consumers and stand out in the marketplace. And needless to say, Disney Plus has exceeded our wildest expectations with 86.8 million subscribers as of December 2nd. That's quite an achievement. This success has bolstered our confidence in our continued acceleration towards a DTC-first business model. And more
directly to consumer.
Walt Disney Company into a new era of delivering consumers truly exceptional entertainment built around our world-renowned brands and franchises. Given that storytelling is at the heart of everything we do at Disney, we're incredibly proud of how much our stories have been embraced by people around the world. 95% of the population in 12 of our top global markets engaged with our content over the past year alone. And more than 1 billion people have identified themselves as true fans with a deep emotional connection to our brands.
Okay.
Since the launch of Disney Plus, we have been working hard to meet the growing demand for entertainment. And now, with our recent reorganization, we've separated content creation from distribution and put in place a new structure that will allow us to be even
Realigned Disney to be all about streaming, which was huge.
In the delivery of our unparalleled programming. This will enable us to tell great stories inspired by the perfect mix of creative excellence data-driven audience insights delivered in ways that consumers want. Our unique access to an incredible number of consumer touch points across our business.
Can I just say, take a second and appreciate, look at all these brands behind him there. Look at all these brands that they are now in control of. It's crazy, including ESPN.
The team is able to better inform our creatives of consumer preferences. And the creative teams are empowered to make the high quality branded entertainment they believe will resonate with audiences.
That's corporate speak for
this
saying,
new organization
we did great
also
things.
Gives us maximum flexibility in determining when and on which platform content will be available. And this is especially important now, given
consumers just kind of repeating a lot of things he said in that press release about 2 months
and
ago.
And the prolonged uncertainty due to the pandemic. As circumstances change, we will continue to consider these and other critical factors when determining what steps we may take to most effectively distribute our programming. Our goal is always to serve consumers in the best way possible.
So basically, what they're talking about is we have just recently restructured all of Disney to focus more on streaming and they put together a new head of all the things that will determine. So basically, Kevin Feige will not decide where Marvel's content will go. Kathleen Kennedy will not decide where Star Wars content will go. They've created a new division that will decide where all the content goes.
Growing and reinventing ourselves. In his words, we keep moving forward, opening new doors and doing new things.
Because we're curious. The little Disney music in the background.
Keeps leading us down new paths. And I strongly believe it is this perpetual willingness to constantly challenge the status quo, to be visionary in our thinking, to take smart, bold risks.
Totally nitpicky, but I think Bob Iger always wore better suits.
That allows
Come on,
Chapek,
up your suit game, buddy.
To thrive in increasingly dynamic environments. Another thing that really sets us apart is the ecosystem that's comprised of our various lines of business and portfolio of great brands and franchises.
Yeah, expected this.
Some of you may be familiar with this 1957 schematic that shows how Walt envisioned the company with everything centered around storytelling.
I know some of you guys are going to find this stuff boring. I actually find this really interesting.
Segments that powered the company's success. And what you see today is a modern incarnation of this same synergy, still rooted in the tremendous strength
All right,
of our
just show us the layout here, Bob. Show us the
collection of brands and franchises.
Yes, you're awesome. You're great.
Our
we get it.
Our unique ecosystem connects us with consumers in ways that no other company can. For example, let's consider the outstanding success of Marvel. With its record-breaking collection of films from the Marvel Cinematic Universe, loved by fans around the world.
Yes, we know. Everybody loves Marvel. We get it.
Number one movie of all time, Avengers Endgame. And we're incredibly excited to show you what the amazing team at Marvel has in store for you later in the presentation.
We're going to show you right now.
Shows headed to Disney Plus, such as the highly anticipated new series, WandaVision, The Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and
Loki.
Yeah,
if it ever happens.
We also can't wait for you to experience the all-new Avengers Campus being built at Disney California Adventure.
By the way, I visited the campus at Disneyland while it was still in construction. It's going to be amazing.
And as you'll see later, our other studios, with their own prolific collection of intellectual property, are developing new storylines and characters.
Somebody's asking if that's somebody in the live chat is asking if Bob Chapek is Bruce Willis.
Will inevitably become part of Disney Plus, further enriching the unmatched offering of content available on the service. Of course, our excitement in the DTC space goes well beyond just Disney+.
Remember again, DTC is direct to consumer. That means Disney+, Hulu, stuff like that.
All of our streaming services, Disney+, ESPN+, and Hulu. And now, with the upcoming launch of our star-branded general entertainment offering outside the U.S., fueled by our amazing creatives,
this will be very key for people who aren't in the States and Canada.
High-quality movies and series from our acquisition of 21st Century Fox, our DTC business will be even more robust and have a greater global reach than ever before.
This is the whole reason they bought Fox.
We're confident the future of the Walt Disney Company is a bright one. We have the best and most respected brands in the world and the most talented people in the industry. And we're taking bold, transformative steps and making the right investments.
I think this is really going to highlight the fact that them buying Fox had nothing to do with X-Men or anything. This was all about their direct-to-consumer stuff, and now they're going to reveal it.
Company during this pivotal time. And like everyone, we are facing some tough short-term challenges. But just as we've done countless times over our nearly 100-year history, we are finding new and innovative ways to entertain and inspire people, which you'll see throughout this presentation. Now, let's welcome Kareem.
Who? Oh, Kareem. I thought he said, let's welcome Kareem.
Good afternoon, everyone.
It's like, Kareem?
I am thrilled to be here representing Disney's new media and entertainment distribution organization, where we have the privilege of sharing the unparalleled stories created across the Walt Disney Company with fans and families around the
world. These are the guys who get to decide where all the new Marvel content goes, where all the new Star Wars content. This guy's going to be really important.
For how we intend to accelerate our growth in the critical direct-to-consumer space in partnership with the creative teams in the studios, general entertainment, and sports organizations. As a company, we were set up to achieve success in an increasingly dynamic environment. And as Bob mentioned, consumer behavior really does drive our decision making. While we have always valued the data gained through our numerous consumer touchpoints, the rapid growth of our portfolio of D2C services provides us with an even greater...
Basically, he's saying, you guys give us lots of money. That's basically what he's saying.
...determine how to optimally engage with our audiences. In fact, our team uses all of the information available to us when determining how best to allocate our annual creative content budgets across platforms, with the goal to maximize both audience engagement and commercial impact.
They also get to decide how much money Marvel and Lucasfilm and all that get to make content. That's how important this new division is. Don't underestimate it.
Branded entertainment to achieve our established growth objectives for all of our platforms, from direct to consumer to linear networks to theatrical exhibition. This exchange of information is a key pillar of our organization's overall strategy, which also relies on the increased flexibility provided by our mix of distribution options, including, in no particular order, releasing content through traditional windows, such as theaters and linear networks, before it is made available on our direct-to-consumer services.
So he's saying they are still going to put some stuff out theatrically.
Theatrical exhibition's ability to help establish major franchises that are at the heart of our Disney flywheel, providing our creative output simultaneously, day and date, on both traditional and D2C
platforms. Okay, that's fascinating. He's saying we're going to use the theatrical still to establish new franchises
for the D2C component.
Oh my God, Premier Access.
Exclusively distributing our content on our streaming services.
Those are two words I didn't want to hear, Premier Access. I did not want to hear that.
And to minimize churn. Of course, regardless of where it originates, all of our films and episodic series will inevitably end up as part of our incredibly rich and increasingly robust library of content on our D2C platforms. Since streaming has quickly become a preferred method of consumption, we are prioritizing our D2C platforms, both in terms of how we distribute our content.
This is what Bob Chapek was saying before. They're now prioritizing
for Disney
streaming.
Plus, Hulu, ESPN Plus, and the upcoming star-branded International General Entertainment offering. By significantly ramping up production for these services, we will not only accelerate the growth of our D2C businesses, but also solidify our deep and very personal relationship with consumers globally. Today, you will see this new strategy clearly reflected as our creative leaders tell you about the phenomenal stories that they're developing, ranging from blockbusters.
So he just kind of reemphasized what we've been talking about for a while. Disney is now making streaming direct to consumer their number one priority. But it sounds like they still want to use a little bit of theatrical too.
You'll be seeing it a lot over the course of the next couple of hours. Just to provide you with a preview, we're happy to announce that over the next few years, we will release roughly 10 Marvel series, 10 Star Wars series,
10 Star Wars
Disney
series,
live action, Disney animation, and Pixar series, as well as 15 Disney live action, Disney animation, and Pixar features, all new and all directly
Pixar's
on Disney Plus.
Series and 15
with these
features.
Disney Plus originals, along with theatrical releases and library titles, we will be adding something new to the service every week. Notably,
10
this
Star Wars series
programming
in the
is
next
a great
years.
Example of how we're able to seamlessly blend long-term planning with the nimbleness required to drive success in a dynamic world. As we're offering both the conclusion of the second season of our hit original series, The Mandalorian, as well as the recently announced debut of Pixar's next masterpiece, Soul,
that comes out,
which was initially slated for theaters. In a similar way, the wealth of Disney Plus content that we'll preview for you today also reflects a mix of stories developed specifically for the service.
Okay, start previewing
along
it.
With content
Stop telling
originally
us you're
going to
preview it. Start previewing
release.
It. Sorry, I'm a little impatient.
In particular, a number of Disney and Pixar films heading to Disney Plus were previously planned as theatrical releases. But as a perfect illustration of our strategic pivot to a D2C first business model,
remember, D2C
we have decided
is direct to
they
consumer,
will now
that means
be
streaming.
Disney Plus originals. Further, in light of continued COVID related challenges in the marketplace and our commitment to providing consumers greater choice than ever before, we are pleased to announce that we will release Walt Disney Animation Studios' epic adventure story, Raya and the Last Dragon, through
in
Disney
theaters.
Plus Premier Access at the same time that we debut the film in theaters.
Okay, so they're
going
to do what
you'll have a chance
Warner
to hear
Brothers
more about
doing.
This highly anticipated film from Jennifer Lee, Chief Creative Officer of Walt Disney Animation, in just a little while.
Okay, you know, I'm not surprised they're doing
that
with
that
Raya.
All of these distribution plans
I actually kind of thought they put Raya just
the
on Disney Plus, but they're going to make it Premier Access.
One of the primary benefits of our new organizational structure is our ability to quickly reevaluate and adjust our plans in light of any changes in the marketplace. and we will continue to shift and optimize our mix of windowed theatrical, day and date, and D2C exclusive offerings according to what is best for the consumer and our businesses. The okay. Walt Disney Company is uniquely positioned to execute this consumer-centric strategy.
I'm curious to
hear we have brands and franchises that
if they will announce any movies that are going to go exclusively to theaters. So far, Ryan the Last Dragon is going to go to theaters and to premiere access in March. Let's see if they say anything strictly theatrical.
All of these factors yield distinct competitive advantages, enabling us to deliver the compelling stories that audiences worldwide have come to expect from Disney in the ever-evolving ways that they prefer to view them. And now, here to share a business update on our direct-to-consumer services, please welcome Rebecca Campbell, Chairman, International Operations, and direct-to-consumer. Thank you.
All right, so this is like the head person of Disney Plus, like the upper boss of Disney Plus.
Today, I'm going to start by updating you on the incredible growth that our streaming services have experienced to date.
This should be interesting.
And then I'm going to give you a preview of the exciting things that we have in store for our global direct-to-consumer offerings. Now, when you heard from us in April of 2019, we shared our guidance for fiscal year 2024. 60 to 90 million Disney Plus subscribers, 40 to 60 million Hulu subscribers,
yeah, those are ambitious
and
numbers.
8 to 12 million ESPN Plus subscribers. I'm thrilled to say that our performance against those goals has been spectacular.
They've blown them away. They've blown those goals away.
As of December 2nd, we now have over 137 million subscriptions across our direct-to-consumer portfolio.
Oh, I thought she was going to say Disney+.
Including 86.8 million Disney+ subscribers.
They've gone up from 73 million to 86 in just a couple of months.
Are Disney+ Hotstar subscribers. 38.8 million Hulu subscribers. And 11.5 million ESPN Plus subscribers.
I love
Due to
Hulu
this exceptional performance out of the gate, our aspirations have grown since we last met. And our CFO, Christine McCarthy, will provide updated guidance for our direct-to-consumer business later today. But first, I want to talk about Disney Plus. And by the way, our amazing storytellers could not have scripted this any better. In just over a year, Disney Plus has cemented its reputation as a singular destination for premium branded content. Subscriber growth demonstrates the incredible consumer response as we've rolled the service out around the world. Our initial launch in the United States, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and the Netherlands.
Still a lot of places waiting.
Yielded an immediate response, 10 million signups as of day one.
Yeah, that was one of
them. And then we quickly expanded across EMEA to the UK, Germany, Italy, Spain, France, and in more than 10 other countries. And then in Asia, we launched Disney Plus Hotstar in India and Indonesia and executed a limited Disney Plus launch in Japan.
I hear a lot from our Indian viewers
that will actually expand to the full market next year. And just last month, we launched in Latin America, including Argentina, Brazil, Mexico, Chile, Colombia, and Peru.
Which a lot of you guys wrote into me to tell me you're excited about, which is great. I'm glad you guys finally got it.
Additional countries in South and Central America. And we're not done yet, as we will be launching in more markets in 2021, including Eastern Europe, South Korea, and Hong Kong, to name a few. Now, to speak more about our global distribution strategy for Disney Plus,
pirate Mandalorian
I'd
anymore.
Like to turn it over to Michael Paul, president of Disney Plus and ESPN Plus.
Disney Plus and ESPN Plus, but
Thanks,
not
Rebecca.
Hulu.
That's
interesting.
A perfect setup. Across the globe, we have built early momentum by meeting customers wherever they are on the devices they prefer. The availability of our app on mobile and connected TV devices has helped us amplify our
reach. By the way, for those of you joining us a little bit late,
and
the big announcement's already. There's
going to
be, over the next couple of years, 10 MCU series for Disney Plus, 10 Star Wars series for Disney Plus, 15 Pixar series for Disney Plus. They've already announced that already.
Apple, Amazon's Fire TV, Google, and Roku, to name a few. I'm excited to announce today our new agreement with Comcast, which will make available a fully integrated Disney Plus and ESPN Plus experience to over 20 million Comcast X1 set-top boxes and Flex platforms, joining Hulu in the first quarter of 2021.
I'm not a Comcast customer, that's interesting.
While we've acquired the majority of our subscribers directly or through third-party app stores, our launch strategy also included wholesale agreements with a variety of distributors to further expand our reach.
This dude's a robot. Yeah, this guy doesn't have a lot of charisma.
We've been pleased with Verizon's Disney Plus on Us promotion. And this past August, we extended our agreement to offer
the
Disney bundle to their premium tier of unlimited customers. Verizon is providing a seamless experience for customers rolling off their initial promotion and upgrading to the Disney bundle. The Disney bundle combines Disney Plus, Hulu, and ESPN Plus in one.
That's
for the
a crazy
low
deal.
Monthly
That's
price
crazy good.
Of $12.99.
I have all
and
three.
And in January, based on feedback from our customers, we'll make a version of the Disney bundle that includes Hulu with no ads for $6 more per month widely available, providing even greater choice and flexibility to our consumers.
If you are a Hulu
in
member
Europe,
like me,
we have distribution
that's huge.
Deals with leading
that's
pay
huge.
TV and mobile network operators, including Canal Plus in France, Deutsche Telekom in Germany, Movistar in Spain, O2 in the UK, and TIM in Italy. In Asia Pacific, we teamed with Jio, India's largest telecom network and the third largest mobile network operator in the world, serving nearly 400 million customers. Together with Jio, we made it simple and convenient for prepaid mobile customers to access Disney Plus Hotstar, helping drive rapid growth in India.
That's
and in Latin America, we collaborated with Mercado Libre, the region's leading e-commerce company with over 76 million active shoppers.
I've
distribution
never heard
of
them. That's
of Disney
huge,
Plus.
Though.
In addition, we are working with market leaders across the region with both a la carte and bundled offers. We have also been ambitious
They're
in experimenting
aggressive.
With reaching new audience segments. Take, for example, our recently launched global offer with Epic Games that bundles Disney Plus with Fortnite purchases. By combining our incredible
no
IP
idea about
with authentic
that.
In-game tie-ins, we're able to market Disney Plus to millions of Fortnite players around the
that.
World. Now I'll turn it back to you, Rebecca, to speak to our Disney Plus engagement strategy.
Thanks, Michael. Disney Plus has provided us the platform to bring more incredible content directly to consumers. At the same time as the world adapted to challenges brought on by the pandemic. And looking ahead, the content slated for Disney Plus over this coming year is truly extraordinary. And I can't
Great.
Wait
Show
for
us.
You to hear more from our amazing content creators later today.
If you keep saying
but
you can't wait to show
there,
us, why are you making us
I'd
wait
to
show us?
I'd love to tell you about how we're approaching the expansion of Disney Plus internationally. So
okay,
as
this
I
will
mentioned
be interesting
earlier,
to our international
our
viewers
launches
for sure.
Around the world have been a key driver of our subscriber growth to date. And what we've done in India will help illustrate how we have adapted our approach. Mm. With a rapidly growing middle class and expanding discretionary spending, India is a promising market opportunity. And
so
we are
this
uniquely
is obviously,
positioned to
this
succeed
is the whole
in India.
Remember, this event is an investor's call, so they're touching
Star
on a lot of this business stuff for their investors. And
this
their expansion in the Indian market
to
is
launch Disney Plus
massive.
In conjunction with Hotstar to create a truly integrated entertainment experience for consumers in that market.
I don't care what anybody
Disney
says.
Plus
I love Lion King.
Hotstar
I love that movie.
A massive collection of local content. From Bollywood films to TV series in seven local languages, adding over 17,000 hours of original local programming every year. And importantly, Disney Plus Hotstar is the exclusive home for the most significant cricket events in the world, the Indian Premier League, the Asia Cup, the Cricket World Cup, and BCCI's India Cricket Rights. On top of that, offering all the best that the Walt Disney Company has in one place has made Disney Plus Hotstar the ultimate streaming destination in India, all at an accessible and an affordable price. Now, this strategy is our template for other South Asian markets, with Indonesia being the first, that are also driven by local content and mobile consumption. We know Disney Plus Hotstar can lead the region as the top streaming service.
I'm getting text messages like every 30 seconds from other people I know that are freaking out over some of this stuff.
In India and Indonesia, we will be launching Star and Star Plus as our general entertainment content brand outside of the United States.
Interesting.
And we will be offering these brands in two different ways, depending on the market. Now, I know that this may be a lot to digest, so let me walk you through it.
I'm surprised they're not putting the word Disney.
And I'd like to explain
the name of Star
strategy. Let's start with Star. In Europe, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, and then a few other markets, Star will be fully integrated into Disney Plus. It will be accessible as the sixth brand tile in the app. Star will add a robust collection of our best original and library general entertainment films and series to exceptional content already available on Disney Plus. Star will include global hit series from Disney Television Studios and FX to blockbuster films and significant library content from the Disney Library and our 21st Century Fox acquisition, to an array of exclusive local original content specifically programmed to appeal to our subscribers within each market.
Again, this is why they bought Fox, guys.
We will be launching Star in many markets on February 23rd, 2021. And we'll also be raising the price of Disney Plus to reflect the value of all of this remarkable content. For example, in continental Europe, we'll be raising the price by €2 to €8.99 with a similar adjustment in other markets. And then we'll use this approach as we launch Disney Plus with Star already included in additional markets, including Japan and South Korea later in 2021.
Okay.
Now, to give us a first look at the Disney Plus service with Star integrated, please welcome our head of product for Disney Plus, Gerald Jimmerson.
This is huge. So many people internationally have been wondering, when are we going to start rolling stuff out more internationally? This is big for the international audiences.
To walk everyone through the Star experience on a connected TV. So what is Star on Disney Plus? Star will bring a wide range of new content for families, older teens, and adults to Disney Plus. Now, when subscribers first encounter the new collection, they'll be greeted with an animation that highlights the new Star tile, as well as the new movies and shows available. Since we'll be adding entertainment with more mature ratings, it's important that we take the time to set expectations with our subscribers and make sure the titles they see are appropriate, even for the youngest members of the family. We've worked hard to make sure our parental controls are second to none.
Okay, so they are bringing the adult stuff
in.
Here you go, and this is how they're going
to
do it.
Access to the expanded catalog. We've created a simple process for them to change their settings in order to view titles with higher ratings. When a subscriber chooses to access the full Star catalog, we'll ask them for their password to confirm that they're the account owner. And we make it crystal clear that by clicking confirm, they're opting in to view content rated 18 and above. And with their
Deadpool's
settings updated,
be there?
Subscribers arrive back at the Disney Plus home screen, where all new content now joins the core family-friendly content of Disney Plus. Joining the other amazing brands that make up Disney Plus is the new Star tile. Like our other five brands, you'll find a dedicated Star landing screen to browse our general entertainment movies and series. Under the Star brand, you'll see newer movies like Kingsman, alongside classics like Die Hard and Alien.
Kingsman
plus
is
great
newer?
Series like Atlanta, Modern Family, Homeland, and The Americans.
Wow.
Returning to home,
this is major
let's
expansion.
Also check out the Marvel brand landing screen. We're now able to include even more movies like Logan and series like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Logan is going to be
and
right in
And for those
there.
With young children, our best-in-class parental controls ensure your family only sees the titles you want them to. With the addition of Star, we're making a service that tens of millions of subscribers already love even more compelling for older
this
teens and adults.
Big.
All while taking great care to ensure Disney Plus remains a secure,
family-friendly
place.
You ever want to see
fans.
A girl fuck a fish?
I'll turn it back to Rebecca to dive into the Star Plus strategy, and I'll be back in a few to to walk you through a first look.
Thanks, Cheryl. Now let's shift to our strategy for Latin America, where we are taking a slightly different approach. Unlike Star, which will be embedded in the Disney Plus app, our general entertainment content in Latin America will be in a standalone app. Given the strength of our sports portfolio in this region, we will launch a direct-to-consumer offering called Star Plus, which will include general entertainment TV series and movies from our studios, and a stunning array of live sports from ESPN, including an all-star portfolio of soccer leagues, Grand Slam tennis, and much more. Star Plus will also have an incredible collection of
By the way, seeing a lot of people asking you this in the U.S., it sounds like that Star thing will be implemented into Disney Plus, where Disney Plus is, and then outside of their existing markets, they'll just be the service Star Plus for everybody else. At least that's what it sounds like. This is huge.
At the new Star Plus streaming service for Latin America.
Now that Rebecca has set up the strategy behind Star Plus, I get to give you a first look at the experience. Star Plus is a standalone app and will have a world-class mix of great general entertainment movies and series.
Remember, again, this is outside of the U.S. Star Plus.
In addition, Star Plus
is outside of the U.S.
From ESPN, a well-respected and recognized brand across Latin America. The first thing you'll notice is a more interactive home screen, where we're showcasing some of the most exciting new content front and center. We've made it easy to find what you love with an updated approach to continue watching. Now, in addition to series like Modern Family and movies like Underwater, you'll also find live event programming like the US Open on ESPN. Continue watching is even smart enough to know when a live event is over and will remove it from view unless an on-demand replay is available. As you scroll down the screen, you'll find blockbuster movies like Deadpool 2 and The Devil Wears Prada. And with new shows and movies from our studio,
that's a weird combo. Deadpool and Devil Wears Prada.
The new to Star Plus row will help subscribers keep up with the always growing collection. Now, moving down the screen, you'll find a row for live sports from ESPN. From this row, you'll be able to see at a glance who's playing, what the score is, and how much time is left.
They're implementing Star into the U.S. Disney Plus network. Outside of the U.S., and a lot of the other markets where Disney Plus isn't yet, they're going
to
just have Star Plus, and they're going to integrate some of Disney's other things like ESPN into it. This is interesting.
It's a window into an incredible variety of sports, and it's all included with your Star Plus subscription.
Deadpool Wears Prada. Somebody said Deadpool Wears Prada in the live chat.
But also a wide range of exclusive live events, all organized so fans can quickly see what's on and find exactly what they're looking for. Helpful features like Live Now, Upcoming, and Smart Content Filters make it easy to zero in on specific sports and leagues from ESPN.
Now again, this isn't applicable to those of us who live in markets where Disney Plus already exists.
To create the best possible consumer experience. But I hope you enjoyed the sneak peek of Star Plus. We're confident Star Plus and Star will become household names for the best in streaming general entertainment content outside of the U.S. And now, bringing it back to our domestic general entertainment strategy, I'd like to welcome Kelly Campbell, president of Hulu.
I love Hulu, so I'm excited about this.
Thanks, Gerald. The year was 2008, and Hulu launched as a disruptor, an innovator, and is part of the movement that ushered in a new era of television.
Deadpool Wears
Prada. Fast forward to today, and Hulu has helped make streaming TV a centerpiece of entertainment for consumers and paved the way for ad-supported streaming.
I probably use Hulu Plus more than I use Netflix.
Hulu is in its strongest position ever, with a rare combination of continued rapid growth and a clear path toward profitability. In just 3 years, Hulu has more than doubled its number of paying subscribers and become the largest digital MVPD service in the U.S. We've achieved this remarkable
growth by providing consumers with the best
of TV, film, news, and sports, live or on demand, all in one cohesive experience. It's that unprecedented level of choice and flexibility that differentiates Hulu. subscribers can choose from the ad-supported SVOD package, SVOD with no ads, or Hulu Plus Live TV, with the option to add premium networks to any of these plans. And we do this in a way that uniquely allows consumers to seamlessly move between products, depending on their changing habits. One key component of that consumer experience is Hulu Plus Live TV. It combines popular live channels across sports,
I did
news,
try Hulu Live TV for a while, and while
Hulu
I love Hulu,
library of
I just found YouTube TV was a
TV
better option than Hulu Live TV,
Hulu,
but I know some other people have Hulu Live TV that really do like
it. The new generation of streamers. At the end of the fiscal year, Hulu Plus Live TV surpassed 4 million paying subscribers, making it the number one digital MVPD service in the U.S., and the fifth largest U.S. pay TV provider overall. Our live TV business offers an incredible value proposition for consumers, as well as positive economics for Hulu. In addition to our new $65 monthly subscriber fee, Hulu Plus Live TV also now generates an average of about $10 per subscriber in ad revenue per month, and therefore drives positive contribution margin.
Now remember, this whole event is for investors and people who own stock, so they're covering these numbers, which I still find is pretty interesting.
Award-winning Hulu original series and films, with next-day episodes of today's biggest hits, popular feature films, and a massive library of fan-favorite series, from Scrubs to Scandal and ER to Empire. Hulu has TV fans covered. So what does the future look like? We see a tremendous opportunity to create even more innovative, differentiated content experiences around the world-class episodic and feature-length programming being made by the Disney Studios and FX. You'll hear more from Dana Walden and John Landgraf later. But I want to take a moment to call out three content initiatives that exemplify what Hulu uniquely can bring to subscribers.
$65 a month for live TV sounds steep, but that's actually kind of in line with what the other services like YouTube TV are doing right now.
Which brings together more than 40 acclaimed and award-winning FX series, including exclusive originals. This delivers a new, younger audience to FX content and provides an exclusive, premium experience for our viewers. Since launching in March, the overall average reach of FX series has increased by nearly 50% on top of their linear audience.
The FX stuff is fantastic. I really do love the FX stuff.
The comedy Babe, in particular, was a smash hit on Hulu, more than doubling the reach of the show's linear broadcast. We've also partnered with ABC News to bring important live news, including coverage of the recent election, to Hulu's millions of on-demand subscribers, something that no other SVOD service in the U.S. offers. During this election season, nearly 4 million of Hulu's SVOD subscribers engaged with election coverage through ABC News Live. And I'm happy to report that we plan to expand our partnership with ABC News to include new original content that will live exclusively on Hulu. The third initiative I'd like to highlight on the content side is Hulu's momentum in the original film space. We've had great success this year with Hulu original
films.
So
Hulu's going to do more original films.
Including the Andy Samberg comedy Palm Springs.
That was actually pretty good.
Indie film hit Bad Hair. And our recent thriller Run, starring Emmy winner Sarah Paulson. Going forward, Hulu will launch exclusive original films produced by 20th Century Studios and Searchlight. We'll have more news on this front in the coming months. Now, on the product side, I'm excited to announce that ESPN Plus and its incredible sports programming will become available for viewing directly within the Hulu interface early next year.
Really?
This means that Hulu
then why have ESPN if you're going
to
make it available on Hulu?
And access ESPN Plus content right in their Hulu experience without ever having to leave the Hulu app. No presentation about Hulu would be complete without a look at our superpower, advertising. For years,
okay,
Hulu
this part's
has driven
boring.
The growth of advertising and streaming TV and is now, with the power of Disney ad sales behind us, the undisputed leader in ad-supported streaming TV. In fact, Hulu now has over 92 million.
I remember recently there
were
some whispers going around
double
that Disney was
just
going to fold Hulu, but apparently
ago.
Not. They're They're talking about its growth. They're talking about they're going to continue to build original movies exclusively for Hulu, which is weird. Like, if you're Disney, why wouldn't you just put all original movies on Disney Plus? But it sounds like they still got a plan. Sounds like they got a plan. I'm happy. I love Hulu.
In a rapidly growing programmatic channel that's setting daily records for new customers and for revenue. And with our new Hulu Ad Manager platform, Disney is the first to make premium streaming TV advertising inventory directly available to the more than 28 million small and medium-sized businesses in the U.S. All of this, our incredible content, seamless product experience, and viewer-first advertising translates into tremendous financial upside. And thanks to the company's strength in advertising, the underlying economics of Hulu's ad-supported product, even at the consumer-friendly $5.99 price point, are generally on par of that with the no-ads product.
Yeah.
We're really proud of what we've built at Hulu and of where Hulu is today.
You've done a good job with Hulu.
Of even more content from our creative partners at Disney Television Studios, FX, ABC News, 20th Century Studios, and Searchlight, we're incredibly optimistic about our future.
Awesome. Now, good to hear.
Let's turn it over to Michael Paul, who will share an ESPN Plus business update.
I was a little bit worried they might fold Hulu.
Thanks,
I'm
Kelly.
Glad to hear they've got future
Hulu's
plans
future
for it.
Really looks exciting.
Oh, this guy
ESPN
again.
Plus quickly became the number
wow,
one
really
sports direct-to-consumer service with its unique and differentiated set
oh,
of
God,
live events,
this guy's voice.
Original programming, and editorial content. Our business strategy includes diversified revenue streams across subscription, advertising, and pay-per-view. We are really proud of the progress we've made to date. Our offering is clearly resonating.
By the way, am I the only one
that
just think this guy's probably terrible at sex? I'm just throwing that out there.
Past year, and we have already
I'm
passed
sure he's a
the
marvelous
midpoint
guy. I'm
of the 2024
fun
subscriber guidance that we gave at last year's Investor Day. Despite an unprecedented year of disruptions, ESPN Plus has delivered over 10,000 live
I'm going to take my
events,
pants off now.
Including all of our top 10 most viewed events ever, with nine of those coming since May. We remain the destination for UFC fans with
damn
millions
right
of pay-per-view
views. And by the way, they're doing a great
the
job with UFC.
Year,
they really are.
Reached as many as a million readers per month of ESPN Plus premium editorial content.
Damn
and as
right.
As Kelly mentioned, making ESPN Plus available for viewing and purchase directly within Hulu will only increase our ability to reach new fans and attract new ones.
Then why do you need the
None
bundle?
None of the success we've seen would be possible without the strength of the ESPN brand and our best-in-class sports content strategy. To dive a little deeper into those topics, I'll now hand it over to Jimmy Pitaro, Chairman, ESPN, and sports content.
Okay. I know a lot of you guys aren't interested in the ESPN stuff, but I really am.
Thanks, Michael. Sports are arguably the most powerful and compelling live content available and are only growing in their importance.
He's also wearing
fact,
the same suit Bob Chapek was.
92 of the top 100 most watched telecasts were sports.
Yes, they
That's
were.
Up from 56 in 2009. And at the Walt Disney Company, we offer an unparalleled array of live sports across our platforms. The ESPN, ABC, ESPN Digital, and ESPN Plus combination is a unique reach machine. A machine that allows us to bring sports fans best-in-class production and storytelling wherever they are. Across our portfolio, ESPN reaches more than 200 million U.S. sports fans in a given month.
But what does this
That's
have to do with Star Wars?
With the total reach
That's what
of
I'm
both
interested
Google
in.
And Facebook. In 2019, and for the 10th consecutive year, our flagship linear network was the number one full-time cable network among the coveted adult 18 to 49 demographic. In digital, ESPN is the number one sports brand and by a wide margin in both reach and
you know,
total
the,
time spent.
Like, I'm not an Apple homer
sports
or anything, but these guys are not doing their presentation skills nearly
our
as good as Apple
ESPN
does.
ESPN Studio in Las Vegas debuted in August, and in September, we announced market-leading partnerships with both Caesars and DraftKings.
Wow, they're getting into
we'll
the sports wager stuff.
Sports
I didn't realize that.
As it represents a key opportunity to better serve our most passionate fans and appeal to a younger audience. Overall, our priority is to make content available across all platforms, and that includes a strong focus on a direct-to-consumer future. Our underlying goal is to acquire, create, and distribute the best sports content, and to do so in a way that serves fans, maximizes consumption, and best positions our business to continue to be the leader in an evolving sports media environment. We continue to expand our number one portfolio.
What does that have to do with Star Wars?
Multi-platform rights.
Or UFC.
And I'm excited to announce today that we've reached an agreement with the Southeastern Conference to expand our partnership and add college football's most watched TV package.
I'm not a huge college football guy, but it is crazy how popular it is in the U.S.
ABC will become the new home for the SEC's marquee Saturday afternoon football games beginning in 2024, as well as select Saturday primetime games and the annual SEC football championship game. In addition, select SEC football games will be made available on ESPN Plus beginning with next football season and extending throughout the term. That means that ESPN.
And again, I want to remind a lot of people that today is not a fan event. Like, this thing is an investor's day at Disney. So they're going to cover a lot of business stuff, but they've already dropped a lot of really huge things. So let's, and I know not everybody's into the ESPN stuff, but they're getting close. We're just a few minutes away now from when they're getting into their full content slate. So hang in there.
Across all sports. In terms of ESPN Plus, our content strategy mirrors the overall ESPN content strategy. Offer the best live rights, the best surround programming across studio, audio, and written editorial, and the best original sports content. Last year, our subscribers watched over 5 billion minutes of live sports content. Soccer, UFC, top-ranked boxing, and college sports are cornerstones of the product. However, ESPN Plus also offers a host of other marquee content, like MLB, NHL, MLS, and as you saw in November, the Masters. And this is just the beginning. Like the SEC,
I didn't realize they moved the Masters to ESPN.
And opportunistically pursued new multi-platform rights for ESPN Plus, with Bundesliga one of the latest on a long list. We're especially excited about our upcoming launch of the PGA Tour on ESPN Plus, where we've secured exclusive rights to PGA Tour Live and will offer 4 live feeds covering up to 8 groups per tournament.
I admit I'm not
ESPN
a golf guy.
ESPN Plus also offers some of the
I want to play golf so I can be cool, but I don't know how to play. I've played golf,
round.
But I'm just no good at it.
Today, I'm excited to announce that we'll be launching a new daily morning highlights program exclusively on ESPN Plus, which will recap the previous night's action through the lens of opinion, debate, and social media.
I thought it was called Sports Center.
This new series will go deep on news, highlights, and trending topics each day with exclusive talent.
Again, I thought that was called Sports Center.
Every show. Additionally, I'm thrilled to announce that early next year, we'll be launching a new studio show that will be exclusive to ESPN Plus featuring Stephen A. Smith. We're excited to bring another personality of his caliber to the
platform. I'm mixed on Stephen A. Sometimes I love him, but sometimes I just think he puts on too much of a show. I'm a little torn on Stephen A.
In terms of originals on ESPN Plus, we can't wait for the upcoming Man in the Arena, a 9-part series built around Tom Brady's never-before-seen first-hand account
greatest of all
of the
time.
Unique journey to each of his 9 Super Bowls. And ESPN Plus will remain the exclusive home of the critically acclaimed 30 for 30 franchise.
By the way, NFL if you guys haven't watched the 30 for 30 stuff, you really should.
And of course, Peyton's Places. I'm very excited to let you know today that we're bringing back Peyton's Places for a 3rd season and also expanding the Emmy-nominated series. But enough from me. Peyton, why don't you give them a little flavor of what's to come?
A little flavor.
Hey, folks, Peyton Manning here. We're smack in the middle of the 2nd season of Peyton's Places. And if I told you that, you know, I'm just tickled
I
pink
love
about
Peyton
how
Manning.
The show
I think I like him even more since he retired. I think he's awesome.
New horizons across the glorious football landscape. You'd say that someone in sales definitely wrote that for me. And you'd be right. But hey, it's the truth. I really do have the greatest job on the planet because in season 2, I get to hang out with the likes of John Elway, Terrell Owens, Ronnie Lott, Marshawn Lynch, President Bill Clinton, and even my old pal, David Letterman.
Man, anyway, Letterman's rocking that beard these days.
As some of the most engaging storytellers
he looks like a cracked out Santa Claus.
Get their very own versions
but
of
I love
Peyton's
Dave.
Places, including Abby Wambach, Ronda Rousey, and David Ortiz. Big Poppy's Places does have a nice ring to it. And if that wasn't enough to get you jacked up, my little brother Eli will also be doing a college football show. So get yourself the whole Disney bundle and join me on ESPN Plus. It's on Jimmy.
I don't know about that one, Peyton, but thank you very much. We're really looking forward to the expansion of this
fantastic series. It's amazing the charisma change. You go from Peyton Manning
to the Disney guys. It's an exciting time to be working on sports at the Walt Disney Company. And as we move forward, we'll continue to build the platform flexibility we need in order to deliver against our mission.
All right.
To serve sports fans anytime, anywhere.
And hey, I'll give them the credit. I've really been enjoying ESPN Plus. I know not everybody's a big sports fan, but I've really been enjoying ESPN Plus.
Will evolve the ESPN offering to meet their needs. Our unique ability to reach fans with compelling sports programming across linear, digital, and direct-to-consumer platforms will further augment our market leadership in the sports space, and we couldn't be more excited about our future. Lowell, back to you.
Oh, good. Back to the exciting guy.
Jimmy.
This guy's a walking orgasm.
We will now take a 10-minute break to give you an opportunity to stretch your legs and grab a snack. And when we resume, we'll be joined by Bob Iger, Disney's executive chairman of the board.
Big Poppy's coming
As executive chairman, Bob directs the company's creative endeavors, and he will introduce the amazing content lineup we are developing for our direct-to-consumer services. So thanks, and we'll see you all in 10 minutes.
Okay, so we've got a little bit of a break here. So, okay, big things so far, the big major things so far. Number one, we got 10 MCU series coming. We have 10 Star Wars series coming. Ryan the Last Dragon is going to do a day and date release, much like HBO is. They're going to go straight to Disney Plus with premium access and in movie theaters. But it sounds like they're going to announce some movies. They're going to go straight thing. We're going to get into the content thing here in just a couple of minutes. Now let's go over and start taking your questions that you guys have been sending in. Hey, John, do you think we might get an update on Indy 5, especially since shooting should start next year? I'm betting we don't hear anything about Indy 5. I still doubt that movie's even going to get made. I'll be honest with you. I still doubt that movie's even going to get made. Okay. Next here, we've got, who was that? Hayden Burke writes, a bit off topic, but oh goddamn, I am stunned that the likely Toby return. Ever since Spider-Man 4 was canceled, I've been shattered, and now seeing my childhood hero return, you can't put that in the words. And I am very, very curious. I am very, very curious to find out if today they are going to actually confirm that. I have a suspicion they will confirm the Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield stuff because it's out there. So they might as well hopefully confirm it. Maybe they will. Maybe they won't. We'll find out for sure in just a few minutes, I think. All right, next up, David Humphrey writes, hello, John. Are you looking forward to The Falcon and Winter Soldier on Disney Plus? I really enjoyed your documentary. Thank you so much, David, for checking out my documentary. I appreciate that. I am very excited for Falcon and Winter Soldier. It is my number one most anticipated upcoming Marvel Disney Plus show. That's the one I am the most excited about. I love those characters. Everything I've heard about it so far is great, and I'm sure we're probably going to hear more about it in a few minutes here. I'm sure they're going to give us some more insight and updates on that here in just a few minutes. Kevin Stevens just sent a super chat to be supportive. Thank you, Kevin. Fernando Alvarez Juarez writes, love the show, John, and keep up the great work. Thank you so much, Fernando, and thanks for being here and checking out this live stream with us. Once again, guys, right now we are... we are 7 minutes out, 7 minutes and 45 seconds out from getting to the content stuff about the announcements today. I'm excited about that. Ryan Holman writes, how important is this presentation for Bob Chapek? This is kind of his first public outing as CEO, right? Very important. I think you're right. I think it's extremely important. I think he's done a good job. Again, his suit game is not nearly as good as Big Papa Iger's, and we're about to see Big Papa Iger come out, and he's going to be probably rocking an amazing suit. But maybe Bob Iger told everybody, all of you guys, wear just plain black suits so I look good. I don't know, maybe. But I do think it's good. And you know what? He's doing pretty good so far. Kevin Stevenson just sends in a super chat to be supportive. Thank you, Kevin. King Roman writes, do you think there will be video game news? I doubt it. Although there's some big video game stuff going on online elsewhere right now. That's for sure. But I don't think there's going to be any video game news. But you never know. Xbox writes, you taking the vaccine? Oh, probably. But again, let's stick with the Disney Plus stuff. Ryan Albanese writes, I'm not a big Marvel or Star Wars movie fan, but this is still exciting. Plus, I own a couple of shares of Disney. So bring on the announcement. And listen, the Disney stocks have been shooting up. the Disney stocks have been shooting up today. So if you're a Disney investor, this has all got to be sweet, sweet music to your ears if you are a Disney investor today. All right, Casinema Reviews writes, if you could pick a director and guest star for an episode of Mandalorian Season 3, who would you pick? Mine would be David Leitch and Kerry Tagawa, Shang-Chi in Mortal Kombat. It's easy. The same guy I've always wanted to see direct a Star Wars thing, Steven Spielberg. Greatest filmmaker of all time, George Lucas's best friend professionally. I've always wanted to see Steven Spielberg get in there and do some Star Wars content. So that would be my vote. That would totally be my vote. Muhammad Ibrahim writes, love the documentary. Thank you so much, man, for checking out my documentary. Any advice for a young filmmaker like me? Maybe one day I'll have one of my own. Listen, the same advice I give everybody all the time who wants to ask me about getting involved in stuff, whether it's filmmaking, YouTubing, whatever, just do it. I mean, I know I sound a little bit like, just do it. I know I sound like him, but honestly, it's just get off your ass and start doing it. Start putting in this work. Do something today, no matter how big or how little, that gets you a little bit closer to what you want to do. Start writing your script. Start figuring out how you're going to edit it. Just do something. Just stop sitting around and waiting. That's the key thing. All right. Kevin Stevenson, thanks for writing that in, Muhammad. Kevin Stevenson writes in, will they mention Avatar? They own that IP. Listen, I'll put it this way. I'm going to be really surprised if they don't mention Avatar, all right? Because they've just spent a ton of money. They've got Avatar 2. They've got Avatar 3. They've got a lot of stuff going. And so I think they will mention it. Listen, Avatar for the longest time was the biggest box office film of all time. This is an investors meeting. Avatar equals money. So I'm going to be shocked. I'm going to be very surprised if they don't talk about it. I think they will, but we'll find out. Mauricio Floresmeyer writes, hey, John, is that the volume where they shoot Mandalorian? I don't think they're in the volume. The volume, of course, is where they do their stagecraft for Mandalorian. I don't think that's where they are, but I wouldn't, you know, now that you mentioned it, Mauricio, I wouldn't be shocked to find out if it is. That's a really good observation. Squirtle Master Kenobi writes, $10 says we don't learn anything new. Well, listen, we already have 10 new series for MCU coming, 10 series for Star Wars, not to mention whatever else they're going to do on top of that. The Ryan the Last Dragon, the fact that they are, I've already said they're going to still put movies out in theater. Some, we'll find out which ones. I don't think Black Widow will be one of them. We've already found out a bunch, and I think the biggest stuff is still to come. I think the biggest stuff is still to come. All right, next up, Glenn Taylor writes, J.I., here's a new documentary called Movie Trailers, A Love Story. Can you tell us where we can find it? I heard it's directed by a breakdancer. Not directed by a breakdancer, per se, no. But let me see if I can bring this up on screen about where you can get it. For those of you, thank you for giving me an opportunity to just shamelessly plug my movie. For those of you interested, my new documentary, Movie Trailers, A Love Story, it is available worldwide at vimeo.com/on-demand/movie-trailers. So it is available there worldwide, but it is also available for people in the US and the UK who might want to watch it on Amazon. It's available for people to watch on Amazon. All right, we got 3 minutes till they're back. So at least thanks again for giving me the opportunity to put in a plug there, Glenn. All right, Little Tom 52 writes, John, you make this so damn fun to watch. Thank you. Well, thanks for being along with me here, guys. We got like 15,000 of us watching this right now. So thank you for watching this with me and giving me some people to talk to. All right. Next up, Alex Acera writes, are Disney and Sony teaming up indefinitely? High hopes, but why else would Marvel want Spidey allegedly to be the new face of Marvel? I don't think they want Spider-Man to be the new face of Marvel. I certainly do hope they continue working together. I mean, listen, the two films they've done together so far, Homecoming and Far From Home, I think have both been really good. And I've enjoyed their collaboration very much. I hope they continue working, but I don't think Spider-Man is going to be the new face of it. But you know what? We'll get a better idea here in a few minutes, Alex. We'll get a better idea in a couple of minutes. 2.5 minutes left. Caesar One writes, let him speak, please. You keep talking over him. Well, that's what I do in Watch Along. I'm here to give my commentary on it. So that's what I do. All right. Genevieve writes, when they were announcing the countries that Disney Plus was available, it was nice to see that Ireland was not lumped in with the UK. Our flag was on its own. Sorry for the patriotism. It was just really great. Hey, listen, I've got a big Canadian flag behind me right here on the floor. I appreciate good patriotism, and I'm glad for you on that. Okay, got time for just a couple more. Ben Rayner writes, so much blue. I don't know what that means, Ben. Sorry about that. Christina B. writes, so Disney is gonna be the new world order. Honestly, kind of scared. Also, over under on just how much AT&T Netflix is pooping their pants right now. They're all pooping their pants right now. I'm telling you what, this new thing about Star being integrated into Disney Plus, bringing the R-rated content, which I always thought they would just strictly do R-rated content to go over to Hulu, but it sounds like Hulu is, we thought Hulu was closing its doors. It sounds like Hulu, they're going to expand their stuff on Hulu. They're going to make new original films for Hulu and bring the Star thing over. This, I'm telling you guys, this, they haven't even gotten to the content stuff yet. We're still a minute out from the content stuff, and this has been pretty exciting to me. I think this has been really damn exciting so far. Mm. Now, I am also a nerd who likes the business stuff and the ESPN stuff, but I have been digging this so far, and they haven't even started talking about Star Wars yet or the MCU yet. So for me, this has been great. This has been really great. Let me get to one more quick one here. We've got a chance here. Big Poppy writes, John, since breakdancing will be a medal sport in 2024 Olympics, will you be coming out of retirement and represent Canada? I love the doc. No, I will not. And for those, some of you may not know, I actually used to be a professional breakdancer. By professional, I mean when I was a kid, I actually had some paid breakdancing gigs. I was really into breakdancing as a kid. I kid you not. But no. Even though, dumb, they've just announced that breakdancing will be an Olympic sport, I will not be participating. Maybe I can be a coach for Team Canada. Who knows? All right, let's get back over here and see where they're going to be going next here. What's up now?
When I became CEO 15 years ago,
Big Pop Iger, and he's wearing the black suit.
I envisioned a world where distribution, powered by transformative technology, would expand dramatically, almost to the point of becoming a commodity. If we could harness that technology and couple it with our extraordinary content, we would be well positioned to not only withstand disruption, but to thrive in a new, increasingly dynamic environment. That thinking led to the acquisitions of Pixar, Marvel, Lucasfilm, and 21st Century Fox, each bringing with them a breathtaking array of branded content and the ability to create even more of it. Fast forward, and in just a year, we've established ourselves as one of the true leaders in the direct-to-consumer space.
Yes, you have,
and
Big Papa Iger.
And what you'll see today reflects an increased commitment to focus the resources and immense creativity across our company on delivering an extraordinary direct-to-consumer experience, unlike anything else that's in the market.
In other words, Disney Plus is what Disney's all about now.
You're about to hear from our amazing executives and get a preview of what they've been hard at work creating for Hulu, Star, and Disney Plus. We love what we are seeing, and we're confident audiences around the world will too. When I stepped down as CEO 9 months ago, my priority became the supervision of our content creation across all segments and territories, with a focus on leveraging our brands and expanding on
now
what
we've
already
achieved.
Remember,
even though he's not CEO, he is still the chairman
the
of the board. He's still Bob Chapek's boss.
The way to grow our subscriber base is with great content. And as we increase our output,
let's talk content.
The emphasis will always be on quality, not volume. Quality holds its value, and that has been our mantra for as long as we've been telling stories. In fact, one thing you'll notice immediately is the high quality of our storytelling, and it is evident across all of our distribution platforms. Production values and talent for our streaming content, both in front of and behind the camera, are on par with our theatrical releases.
Okay, let's get into the good
truly,
stuff.
Truly, the only difference between these and our feature films is length. You'll also see that we are redoubling our efforts to create rich, diverse content that best represents the world we live in and the consumers that we're making that content for. It's very important to us that when people watch our shows and movies,
so they basically
they
consider their Disney Plus stuff every bit as valuable as their theatrical movie
in
stuff.
Our stories. And by further expanding our storytelling to include a multitude of perspectives, we believe we will forge an even stronger connection with our consumers. We've got an incredible slate of new content to show you today. It's going to take us a while to get through all of it, but
that's
we
okay.
promise you it will be worth sticking around for. And since all of you are watching this from home, it's not like you have anywhere else to go. Dana Walden
oh,
will kick
Bob.
Things off, but first, here's a great sizzle of what's in store for our general entertainment platforms.
Sizzle reel. I didn't think we were going to get a sizzle reel. Their sizzle reel is we got to wait 2 minutes? Really? Did they just hit the wrong button? Did they have to load the film cartridge? What the hell is this? Seriously, really? Okay, so anyway, obviously, Bob Iger just reaffirming, yeah, listen, we have repositioned our company. We're all about the direct-to-consumer business. We're Disney Plus, blah, blah, blah. We believe every cent, every ounce of quality that we put in our motion pictures. Don't expect to see a step down in quality with our Disney Plus thing, and we're about to get a whole bunch of stuff. But, wow, why take it? We just took a 10-minute break. Why are we taking another break? What's the, like, I don't know. Did Bob Iger just suddenly realize he had to take a piss? Is that what's going on here? Even Big Poppy Iger's got to go take a piss once in a while, I suppose. So I guess, hey, listen, we got 90 seconds here or 70 seconds. Let's take a couple of questions here. Ted A just sent in a super chat to be supportive. Thank you, Ted. Mike Farina writes, looking at Disney's Twitter, it looks like Star is only international, not USA. I'm not talking about Star Plus, but that doesn't make any sense to me. Well, I'll have to get some clarification on that. Because why put Star as a section on Disney Plus, but only that in other countries? That doesn't seem to make sense to me. We'll have to look into that a little bit more. Just Don't Cry writes, John, you need to see Run. That's what everybody's been telling me, is that we need to go see Run. And so I will see Run because it sounds pretty good. William Jones writes, this is my first time watching one of these with John's commentary. I'm laughing so hard. Well, I'm glad we could be here and help out a little bit. Okay, 30 seconds left. We'll do Philip Baker, who writes, John, I pay $65 a month for Hulu Live TV, ESPN Plus, and Disney Plus, all packaged together. Also, Hulu is included in this as well. That's a nice package deal. I gotta look into that. But, well, I mean, the problem is, while Hulu's live TV thing is good, their live TV service is good, I just happen to personally prefer YouTube TV. It just worked for me a little bit better. Okay, let's get to this sizzle reel. Let's get to it, guys.
Hello. What you just saw in that reel and all around me are some of the biggest hits in the TV industry.
I get it.
Here's what they have in common.
The reel.
They've all been developed
was
and
not
produced
to
by
be
content
streamed.
Creators inside the Walt Disney Company. These are high quality.
Okay, they apparently somebody took the reel. They did put the reel
shows.
Online. The
they've
reel's going to be online to watch.
And
so that's what the break was.
The
so
world.
Now they'll just have to talk
Our
about the
teams
content.
Have produced the top ranked show for every broadcast network and many cable channels. And
Damn
now
it.
We're laser focused on creating great content for Disney's streaming platforms.
Okay, talk
Our
about
content
it.
Strategy, highly curated programming. We're making hard choices about which shows we produce. Landing
I was wondering,
on
what the hell's going on? Why is there
and
a
is
break?
Highly
I get it.
Entertaining
okay.
and part of the cultural conversation. Shows like Little Fires Everywhere. This was the addictive hit starring Reese Witherspoon and Kerry Washington.
I never did watch this, but everybody
Hulu,
said it was good.
Proving the value of juicy, can't turn it off content. Next year, we have new series coming from many of our studio's longtime partners, including the creators of This Is Us, New Girl, and Empire. So how do we know these are the right creators? Because the shows I just mentioned have all been hits here and around the world. And this is what they have coming up.
My wife is addicted
Only Murders
to
in the
This
Building
Is Us.
Reunites two comedy legends. They'll be joined by one of the most popular stars on the planet, someone who has over 370 million followers.
Oh. Martin Short and Steve Martin are doing a show together? All right, sign me up. All they need is Chevy Chase and they got the Three Amigos back together again. Sign me up. This sounds great. Although, why are they hanging on the screen? I'm not sure. Probably because they're probably, and Selena Gomez is going to be joining them, probably they're showing a sizzle of this to the investors and not putting it on the stream right now. I'm guessing. But, yeah, sign me up. Steve Martin, because I don't know if you guys saw it. Steve Martin and Martin Short did like a comedy tour and a comedy special thing. These guys, first of all, I love them. By the way, Martin Short went to school in my hometown of Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. He went to McMaster University. And Steve Martin is just an absolute legend. Interesting. Oh God, I wonder if this is the rest of the stream's gonna be like this. They're gonna announce a new show and then put up like a flat screen while they're showing the investors the sizzle. I'm sure all the sizzle stuff is gonna be available online.
These next two series are ripped from the headlines, the type of stories our audience loves. The Dropout is the unbelievable story of Elizabeth Holmes. She's the Silicon Valley con artist who captivated the world. This show started with a gripping investigation and podcast produced by our very own
ABC
News.
Okay, so this could be like a docuseries? And we got Kate McKinnon is going to be in this one. Again, they're probably showing a sizzle. So The Dropout, it sounds, so it's the based on the true events of that woman who got busted. That sounds interesting. I'm not going to lie. Look, I like Kate McKinnon very much, but I'm far more interested in that Steve Martin and Martin Short one. But this could be interesting as well. This could be interesting as well. You know what? While they've got these blank screens up, while we wait for them to get to that, let me take a couple more questions. Mac McNulton, Nuttleman, I should say, just sent in a super chat. Thank you. Matt also writes, will they be adding ABC as a sixth icon to Disney Plus? It doesn't sound like it, but it sounds like a lot of their content is going to end up there anyway. So, I mean, it's an interesting, like, that is a good question. Why don't they do that? Maybe they can in the future. All right. X-Skill says, in the end, they get more money to make Star Wars. And I've watched a lot of press conferences, and these speakers are hard at building hype. And even I'm a Disney shareholder. Yeah. Yeah, they're working hard at trying to build. Not doing the best job, though, right now. They're not doing the best job at the moment, though. Okay. Next up, we've got Insomnia. Oh, they're back. Let's get back over to it, guys.
Drama series. It's about heroes who are battling the worst drug crisis in history. It's an important story, and we've assembled an all-star team to tell it.
Dope sick. Michael Keaton, Rosario Dawson, and Peter Scar. Wow, look at the cast of this. Rosario Dawson, of course, she's one of my ultimate dream girls, I'm not going to lie. But she's also the new Ahsoka Tano in Mandalorian. Michael Keaton, legend. Peter Skarsgård is fantastic. So it sounds like this is going to be some kind of hard-hitting drama. Okay. Sign me up. That sounds great to me. Again, I'm sure all this sizzle stuff will be made available online probably a little bit later. It's probably when we're going to get all the sizzle stuff. Let me jump back over and start taking live questions again for a second, just while we're waiting for them to finish that sizzle. With the news today that Disney just did kill the theaters and Netflix. Sorry, with news today, did Disney just kill the theaters and Netflix? Or will Disney at least be the top studio within the entertainment industry? Again, shout out to the chat. Thanks for shouting out to the chat. Listen, it depends on how much they say they're going to go to theaters. But I mean, the death of theaters is something we've been talking a lot about lately, and it sounds like it is a foregone conclusion. And a lot of the stuff they're announcing today on Disney Plus is not going to help. Again, I said at the beginning of this, they'll probably put out some olive branches to the theater industry.
Three distinctive series,
but these are going to help.
Great creators, all featuring major stars and all available on Hulu and Star. And in addition to shows we own, Hulu will also continue
Hulu
to
shows.
Pick series from outside studios, especially shows from exceptional creators like David E. Kelley. He's one of my favorite writers, and I'm proud to have worked with him for the past 28 years.
She looks like the mom from Who's the Boss?
Big Little Lies.
Let's try to remember, who does she look like? She looks like the mom from Who's the Boss?
The next one is for Hulu. Nine Perfect Strangers is a thriller that attracted two of the biggest stars working today.
Nicole Kidman, Melissa McCarthy. Really? Melissa McCarthy with Nicole Kidman and Regina Hall. You know me, guys. I am all about Regina Hall. I love Regina Hall. So, okay, interest. Nine Perfect Strangers. Nicole Kidman's been on a real roll lately. Like between the Lies show, and then she's got that one that's out right now that everybody's talking about. And then Melissa McCarthy. I've only seen her try to do drama the one time, and it got an Academy Award nomination. So, I mean, that's all right. And Regina Hall, again, I'm all about Regina Hall. Let's jump back over for a second here. Take more live questions while we wait for the next show to come up. MCV Multicomic Verse writes, chances that Kathleen Kennedy is out and Jon Favreau is in. Not today. I don't think very good chances of that today. Ultimately, yeah, I think Kathleen Kennedy is going to be out within the next year. And I hope it's Jon Favreau, but I'm sure they'll find a great replacement for her either way. Hamza Hussein writes, love the show, John. Hi from London. Hello from London. Thanks for being here and joining us today. Hamza, I appreciate that. Nikhil Gangar Mani writes, Disney Plus Hotstar is so good and my go-to place. Listen, I've been hearing from our viewers in India for a while that Hotstar, which were a lot where all the Disney Plus would the Disney content was ending up on Hotstar. I've been hearing from our viewers in India for a long time that they really like that Hotstar service. And it sounds like that's morphing into just Star. So we'll see where that goes. All right.
And while we're hard at work on new series, Hulu also has returning hits like Golden Globe winner Rami, Emmy nominated The Great, an Emmy, Golden Globe, and Peabody Award winner, The Handmaid's Tale.
Seriously, guys,
The Handmaid's Tale, Handmaid's Tale isn't just hype.
It's an awesome show. It is awesome.
There are many critically acclaimed shows out there, but none have pierced the culture like this one.
Oh, they're actually going to show us the sizzle. Like, guys. Handmaid's Tale is freaking amazing. Started.
She is out there planning who knows what kind of atrocities to visit upon our righteous nation.
What happens in the next few weeks will determine the future of this country.
Canada!
Change never comes easy. This war isn't going to win itself.
Blessed be the squad.
It's not safe where we're going. It's not safe anywhere.
You can't save her. Someone who don't want to be saved.
We can't rest. We're the ones we've been waiting for.
Seriously, guys, the show is awesome. It didn't look like a show for me either, and Anne got me to watch it, and it's pretty damn
awesome.
Handmaids
is the biggest hit in the history of Hulu, and we are committed to its future. As a matter of fact, I'm happy to announce today that we're ordering season 5.
Wow.
Now I want to talk about adult animation for just a moment.
Okay.
Look at the shows we've produced over the past 3 decades. We have the largest library anywhere.
I love Futurama.
And we're making more than 1,500 episodes available for Hulu and Star. And finally, I want to talk about reality shows because the Hulu audience loves them. But remember our strategy for originals. It's not about volume. It's about picking the right ideas and the perfect partners.
I'm not big on reality TV.
Noisy breakout stars who create conversation. Well, no one does it better than this group.
Oh my God, I thought they were finally going off the air. Okay, looks like there's going to be more Kardashian stuff. Again, we can't see the sizzle right now, but it appears there's going to be more Kardashian stuff. Okay, let's get a couple more questions in here while we're waiting for the Kardashian nonsense to end. Nikhil writes that Disney Hotstar is so good. My go play flip. Roxy Logan just sends in a super chat to be supportive. Thank you, Roxy. Appreciate that. Hulkster79 writes, any chance on Lizzie McGuire show news? Maybe. That was a huge bit of drama with Lizzie McGuire. They announced it at D23, then all of a sudden wasn't happening. Maybe we hear something about it, or maybe they'll stay completely silent on it. It's a good question. We'll find out. Jonathan Goff writes, will the Fox movies land on Hulu in the US? I'm not sure. I mean, it sounds to me like they will be making their way over to Disney Plus, and they'll be creating an 18 plus section for that, which I'm a little bit surprised about, to be honest. But maybe they'll discuss that today. Okay, we'll get to Benson Prince in just a second here.
Global stars to a global audience. What I've shared today is just some of what's in store. Our biggest hit makers are creating great shows that we will make available to Hulu and Star. They'll join an incredible lineup from our vast library. It's truly game-changing. And speaking of game-changers, I'm happy to introduce the longtime leader of the most prestigious brand in our industry. Here's my great colleague, John Landgraf, to talk about FX.
FX makes some good stuff.
Thanks very much, Dana.
Why is his head so big on
screen? I've been honored to be your colleague over these many years, and I'm so happy we get to continue our wonderful partnership at our new home. 25 years ago, FX began as a location rather than a mark of any particular distinction or quality.
Oh, that's why.
Specifically, FX was just the name of a linear channel in a cable program guide. Still, one thing we all know from the great legacy of Disney is that if you work hard enough, you can sometimes take a once ordinary location, just a vacant plot of land, and invest enough passion and creativity in it to make it an extraordinary destination and brand.
Over the past 20 years, by working with great creative talent to bring exceptionally compelling original stories and characters to our audience, FX has made the name of our little channel, one of the more than 500 just like it, into something truly special. So,
yeah, they've done a great job.
How did we get here?
With Sons of Anarchy, baby.
We focused relentlessly on giving our audience some of the very best television anywhere, and they responded by turning FX into more than just the name of a cable channel. FX became a real brand, a mark of quality, wherever it might be located.
Archer's my favorite animated show, maybe ever.
Show after show, and year after year, from the fans of our distinct and reliably excellent original
programming. What a great lineup.
This is because FX shows consistently score incredibly high marks with audiences. For the past 18 years, since the launch of our first premium original series, the award-winning and history-making drama, The Shield, the FX batting average in user ratings at the Internet Movie Database on a scale of 1 to 10 is among the best in U.S. television at every elite level. 7 out of 10 stars and above, 7.5 and above, 8 and above, and 8.5 and above. These are batting average for quality for our scripted television programs premiering
really.
In the U.S. for almost
yeah.
2 decades. For example,
leaning on IMDb rating numbers is not
78% of all FX shows
do,
are
whatever.
Rated 7.5
Play
out of
strengths.
10 or above by IMDb users. And we fare even better on Rotten Tomatoes. There, 74% of our shows post an audience score of 80% or better.
That's impressive.
For every original FX series ever made, the overall average score with Rotten Tomatoes audiences stands at an incredible 86%.
That's
However,
impressive.
Despite FX's 2 decades of creating excellent shows, much of that success achieved side by side with my longtime creative colleague and partner, Dana Walden, linear channels are just not the optimal location for a couple of thousand great episodes of television. And that fact caused many FX original series to be licensed and scattered across numerous other platforms, sometimes resulting in confusion as to which brand was actually responsible for fostering these
beloved
shows.
This is all very true, actually, what he's saying right now.
This is good
insight.
Which acquired both FX and a majority stake in Hulu, and then enhanced the growth of FX as a brand by creating an FX-branded presence on Hulu,
yeah,
which has now become the singular U.S. streaming location at which the past, present, and future of FX's great shows could be gathered. On Hulu, FX has been able to reclaim 18 years of great work and to finally distill our brand's entire legacy in a permanent streaming home as the foundation of quality that it is.
Mostly kind of surprised
this
they didn't make an
has
FX
been thrilling, but it has
standalone
also allowed
streamer,
us to do so much more.
But they've looped it into Hulu, which
Since
is great.
Since March, we have made all of our great FX linear originals available to Hulu subscribers the day after they premiere on our channels. To put the extraordinary impact of this opportunity in perspective, the average audience of FX scripted series launched on Hulu has increased 120% over their audience on our channels and VOD sites
alone.
Wow. 120%.
Guys, don't
and
just gloss over how big of a number that is actually
provides,
really significant.
Every single one of FX's returning series has posted year-over-year viewership
Mayans.
Increases. So the addition of the FX brand has significantly expanded the audience reach for FX, and added to the outstanding results Hulu has already been achieving with their own excellent original programming. Mm. But the best is still to come. Because of production delays due to COVID-19, the full benefit of FX's hit current programming has yet to be realized. However,
yeah,
most of our shows are back up and running, and we expect to begin rolling out shows again early next year. New seasons of FX linear series coming soon to Hulu subscribers include Atlanta, American Horror Story, Dave, What We Do in the Shadows,
Mayans,
Better
what
Things,
we do in the shadows.
Snowfall, and Archer. And
Archer.
I'm delighted to announce today 4 more seasons of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, which will take Sunny to season 18, 4 seasons
four
longer
more
than
seasons?
The prior record holder for longest-running live-action sitcom in television history. Ozzie
four
and Harriet.
More seasons?
Even more importantly, the FX brand is now expanding its offering of original programs by making exclusive branded FX original series for Hulu. We will also make those shows available globally to Star. FX had outstanding success last year with our first 3 FX exclusives on Hulu, Mrs. America, Devs, and A Teacher. And even with COVID-19 slowing us down, our FX on Hulu exclusive slate expands next year to include The Old Man starring Jeff Bridges,
Can't
American
wait for that.
Horror Stories, a new anthology series
by Ryan
Murphy.
I don't actually watch
Murphy,
American Horror Story.
Spun off from our
People,
biggest,
you guys should tell me if it's good
FX
if I should watch it.
Drama hit. Platform, an innovative scripted anthology about the craziest aspects of pop culture from BJ Novak.
The guy from The
actor
Office.
An award-winning writer of The Office. Reservation Dogs, a new half-hour series co-created by Academy Award winner Taika Waititi and Sterling Harjo, a Native American who also directed the pilot episode.
I'm not even familiar with that. That's something.
A new drama series based on the acclaimed and beloved graphic novels.
Finally, Why the Last Man.
You can see how well Disney's strategy to brand FX content is already working and how bright the future is for both the FX brand and for the contributions it will make to both Hulu in the U.S. and Star internationally. The FX brand will quickly be able to double our output, making and marketing about 30 original programs each year. While I know that doesn't sound like a huge number in the era of peak TV, I assure you that these 30 shows will punch vastly above their numerical weight, just as FX originals always have, because we will strive, as always, to ensure that every single one of them will be excellent. A truly great aspect of the streaming era, as Disney quickly and overwhelmingly demonstrated with Disney Plus, and as FX has now been able to replicate with the success of FX originals streamed on Hulu, is that today's new programming is tomorrow's perpetual library. Because of this, FX and all of Disney's many brands can create incredible long-term value for fans and shareholders, because we know that streaming subscribers will now be able to easily and conveniently find, treasure, and share their favorite series and characters. Disney has always understood that quality is the surest path to value, which is why for almost a century, it has devoted itself more than any other entertainment company to consistently creating truly great and memorable stories.
Remember, FX the reason Disney bought them was for library, content,
and the
IP.
Of our brand is
this
built
is the fulfillment of that
Finally,
whole strategy.
I'll conclude today's presentation with a few examples of some new and unique branded FX original series that are currently in the pipeline. We are moving quickly to bring audiences the first television series based on one of the greatest science fiction horror classics ever made, Alien. FX's Alien will be helmed by Fargo and Legion's Noah Hawley, stepping into the creator, executive
Noah
producer
Hawley's
chair,
doing it.
Working alongside Sir Ridley Scott. Set
and
not
Ridley
too far
Scott's
into
involved?
Our future, it's the first Alien story set on Earth. And by blending both the timeless horror of the first Alien film with the nonstop action of the second, it's going to be a scary thrill ride that will blow people back in their seats.
Unbelievable. And Ridley Scott's involved. And Noah Hawley's doing it. And now they're running a thing. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? That Noah Hawley is doing it. I heard some stuff about an Alien series, stuff like that. Noah Hawley and Ridley Scott working on it. I had basically given up. I'm not going to lie to you. I had basically given up on the Alien franchise. But that sounds amazing. That sounds amazing. And I cannot wait to see what they're going to do with that. That's amazing. Okay, so we got an Alien series coming to Hulu. Being run by Noah Hawley. Unbelievable. Okay, see what's up next.
And finally, we'll be embarking on one of the most sweeping, sophisticated, and adult series FX has ever created. A retelling of James Clavell's beloved epic saga, Shogun.
If you guys have watched me for any period of time, you know Shogun is the one thing I've always wanted them to do again.
Justin Marks and Rachel Kondo. Tim Van Patten, the highly decorated, award-winning producer of The Sopranos and Boardwalk Empire, and the director of the
Shogun
pilot
is
and early
awesome.
Episodes of Game of Thrones, has signed on to bring this giant and visceral canvas to life. So those are just some of the many exciting projects we have
been
in our slate.
Begging.
Along with a number
years
of others in early
for somebody to do Shogun again.
In the coming
years,
months.
I've been waiting for somebody to
All
do Shogun again.
All of us at
again.
FX are truly honored to be a part of the Walt Disney Company, where we will continue our mission to deliver outstanding adult programs that engender passion from our viewers, and to grow the FX brand's value as a beacon of quality within TV streaming.
Shogun.
Future. That's it for me today.
Shogun.
Thanks for your time.
Amazing.
And now back to Rebecca.
Well
Kennedy.
Done, FX. Well done.
Thank you, John. We believe that Hulu, Star, Star Plus, and Disney Plus Hotstar are perfectly suited to host the general entertainment content we create from our world-class production engines. Our Hulu joint venture will continue to license all original scripted streaming content.
Hulu's going to kick ass, man.
And most off-network content created by Disney Television Studios and FX. Star, Star Plus, and Disney Plus Hotstar will be the exclusive home of our original content and much of the off-network content outside of the United States.
Nice.
Also, each of these services will be enhanced by the addition of local programming. So looking ahead, our plan is to grow with premium content for everyone, engaging our existing subscribers and helping us to attract new ones. And now, we're going to switch gears.
Yes,
it's time to hear from our brilliant content creators for Disney Plus.
Oh, here we go.
Starting with Lucasfilm, please welcome Kathleen Kennedy.
Here we go. Star Wars stuff. Here we go.
Thank you, Rebecca. It's remarkable to be back here with you again for another Investor Day and reflect on all that's happened since we last gathered in April of 2019. Our world and our entire industry has been thrown numerous challenges that none of us could have foreseen.
Obi-Wan, Obi-Wan, Obi-Wan.
As we grapple with one of the most difficult periods in modern history, it's clear that we need great storytelling and the joy of entertainment more than ever before. Last year, we were looking ahead to the launch of Disney Plus with our very first live-action series, The Mandalorian. Star Wars was moving into new territory in the streaming space on a brand new platform, creating an original series through groundbreaking technology and an entirely new approach to production and filmmaking. It was a big bet and a leap of faith. The Mandalorian debuted on Disney Plus in November of 2019, and the response has been overwhelming. We could not be more humbled by the reception to the show, the honor of 7 Emmy Awards, and the enormous support our fans have shown us. With The Mandalorian on Disney Plus, we have ushered in an entirely new era for Star Wars, and there's more to come. We premiered season 2 on October 30th, and Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni continuing the journey of The Mandalorian and the Child. Audiences around the world have joined the adventure on Disney Plus, traveling to new planets with incredible action, larger-than-life creatures, delivering a complete cinematic experience. Let's take a look at season 2.
But we've already been watching season 2. Okay, whatever. Sure, let's take a look at season 2, even though we've already been watching it.
Very special, kid. I agreed to take you back to your own kind, so that's what I need to do. And they're going to take real good care of you. I've been quested with returning this child to the Jedi.
The season has been awesome.
What do you know of the Jedi?
Bo-Katan. Nothing.
I can lead you to one of their kind. But first, we need your help on our mission.
Sasha Banks.
Mission.
I seriously suspect we are going to get a Bo-Katan series announcement.
How's my credit around here?
And you come here, little one. Have you been taking good care of him? Has Mando been taking good care of you, huh? Yeah.
Yeah, he said.
What is that thing?
I keep it around for luck.
You're gonna need it where you're headed.
Ah, Michael Biehn. Come on, show some stuff that we haven't seen yet.
The Jedi Order fell a long time ago.
So did the Empire, yet it still hunts him.
Long live the Empire. Long live the Empire.
Tolliver. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love Mandalorian, and I love what we've seen so far, but why did you have to show us this big montage of stuff we've already watched? That shot reminds me of Firefly. Serenity and Firefly.
I've been tracking you, Mandalorian.
here for the armor.
If you want my armor, you'll have to peel it off my dead body.
I don't want your armor.
Boba Fett! John Wick of the Star Wars universe.
I want my armor.
Boba Fett. John Wick. Okay, but I mean, why did we have to see
that? Today I'm excited to share with you that John and Dave are concurrently developing two new spin-off series exclusively for Disney Plus. One, The Rangers of the New Republic, and the other featuring fan favorite Ahsoka Tano.
There it is. I knew that show was coming.
Set within the timeline of The Mandalorian, these interconnected shows, along with future stories, will excite new audiences, embrace our most passionate fans, and will culminate in a climactic story event. The next chapter will debut on Disney Plus Christmas of 2021. I'm fortunate to be surrounded by incredible talent, both in front of and behind the camera, with a company full of people who care passionately about high quality storytelling. A few times in my career, I've had a chance to be part of game-changing technology.
Come on, tell us more about this
Rangers
show.
Moments when a new way of filmmaking changed the way stories could be told forever. Working with Jon Favreau to create the world of The Mandalorian with our own Stagecraft technology has been one of those moments. Stagecraft is a new virtual production tool that utilizes the latest innovations in real-time graphics and massive LED screens that allows us to bring entire locations into a soundstage and photograph them live.
Okay,
telling
we know
stories
about
in
Stagecraft,
ways we could only dream.
Okay, so
if
we, I told you guys last night on Twitter they're going to announce an Ahsoka Tano thing today. So
this
there's
new
that.
Collaboration
this Rangers of the New
the
Republic,
the
though, I wonder if this is going to have Mr. Kim, the X-wing pilot that's been showing up. I wonder if they're going
to
give him a show. Probably not.
And post,
but you know what? It could have.
All in sync to preserve the
it could be Cara Dune. This Rangers of the New Republic could be Cara Dune. I don't know that. I'm just kind of speculating that that could be it.
By eliminating unnecessary travel, a more controlled environment, and efficiencies with set design and special effects that allow for an in-camera visual experience, actors are immersed in those environments rather than having to imagine what they're seeing or reacting to. And ironically, the efficiency of Stagecraft has allowed us to continue to work during this pandemic. On The Mandalorian Season 2, we expanded Stagecraft's capabilities further and built an even larger volume.
Wow.
Additionally, we are building three more volumes right now in Los Angeles, London, and Australia, advancing the Disney-owned technology and building the studio of the future. We have a vast and expansive timeline in the Star Wars mythology, spanning over 25,000 years of history in the galaxy, with each era being a rich resource for storytelling. Now with Disney Plus, we can explore limitless story possibilities like never before and fulfill the promise that there is truly a Star Wars story for everyone. One of the most exciting and ambitious new series we have coming to Disney Plus in 2022 is Andor, a tense, nail-biting spy thriller in the Star Wars universe created by Tony Gilroy. Tony's incredible success with the Bourne Identity films distinguishes him as one of today's best creators of the modern spy genre.
He did a lot of work on Rogue
One as well. We couldn't
be
more thrilled to have him at the helm of this new series for Star Wars. Diego Luna will be back in the role of rebel spy Cassian Andor from Rogue One, and he will be joined by a fantastic new cast that includes Stellan Skarsgård, Adria Arjona, Fiona Shaw, Denise Goff, Kyle Soller, and Genevieve O'Reilly as Mon Mothma. We just began production in London 2 weeks ago.
Yeah,
here's
they
a special look
that.
At Andor.
Are they going to show it? They are showing it.
Everything I did for the rebellion.
Rogue One, in many ways, it's a film that connected new audiences with the oldest fans.
I was there.
It was a bittersweet feeling, you know, in the premiere, knowing that it was just one film. But then magic happens, right?
As you can see, we're getting ready. We're building stages, we're rehearsing, we're training, we're trying costumes, we're doing everything to make sure we do the best show.
I'm really excited having the chance to explore Cassian. It's really fun to go on a set that is emulating something you like so much.
The enormity of this is like doing a big feature film.
It's very cinematic. For me, that's where the excitement is.
12 episodes, 12 scripts, over 200 named cast members.
I like
members,
that so much. It's practical sets and stuff
people.
Like that. That's pretty cool.
A lot
cool.
of creatures are coming from the creature department.
We treat this exactly like we would have filmed. There is no difference in our approach.
Every creature and droid that we've been building has the same care and level of attention to detail as the previous films.
It's huge, it's thrilling, but also it's wonderfully challenging.
There's tons of possibilities to explore. It is the building of a revolution.
I gotta tell you, I'm looking forward to this. I love the character. I want to hear about a gritty rebellion because, you know, if you're going to have rebellion, people got to get their hands bloody, and I want to see
last
this show.
Last August at the D23 Expo Obi-Wan, in Anaheim, we announced the return of Ewan McGregor in the iconic role of Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi for a special event series on Disney+. Obi-Wan Kenobi begins 10 years after the dramatic events of Revenge of the Sith, where he faced his greatest defeat, the downfall and corruption of his best friend and Jedi apprentice, Anakin Skywalker turned evil Sith Lord, Darth Vader. Our fans will be thrilled that Hayden Christensen will be returning in the role of Darth Vader.
Good Canadian kid, Hayden Christensen is coming back.
The rematch of the century. The series is directed by Deborah Chow, coming off the great work she did with us as a director on season one of The Mandalorian. Production will begin in March of next year. Here's an early look at Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Which they haven't started. Oh, okay. So they haven't even started shooting yet. So we got two minutes to kill here. All right, listen. Wow, where to begin? So Cassian Andor, I want to know more about this Rangers of the New Republic. Again, my guess is that Cara Dune, because you know she got that little badge now, since it's happening at the same time as Mandalorian, I'm guessing that's going to be part of it. I'm guessing. I don't know. Maybe not. Of course, the Ahsoka Tano thing, that became a no-brainer. I'm a little bit surprised they didn't say a Bo-Katan series. I kind of thought they might set that up. Maybe they're going to use Bo-Katan more in Mandalorian itself. And I'm surprised they haven't talked about Mandalorian Season 3 so far. Obi-Wan is coming. They start shooting in March. This is great. I mean, obviously, this was supposed to be a show that was should have been well into production already, but they had those delays. So that's really good to hear. The expansion of them building three more stagecraft facilities, that is massive. But it also makes sense because if they're saying they got 10 new series coming, they're going to need more than one stagecraft location in order to fulfill all the needs of what they're going to have in order to fulfill all those episodes, all those shows. Because like one season of 10 episodes, that's 80 episodes they got to make. So they're going to need to expand their facilities and all that kind of stuff. Hayden Christensen, listen, I didn't think it would actually happen. I mean, when Hayden Christensen came and appeared at Star Wars Celebration a couple of years ago, I was there. I remember thinking, oh, maybe this could open the door sometime in the future. I really didn't think it would be for the Obi-Wan series, but a bunch of you guys did speculate that we might see Hayden Christensen back, and you were bang on the money. So it sounds like we're going to get Obi-Wan and Anakin, how they're going to do it, whether it's a Force Ghost situation or flashbacks. I mean, who knows what they're going to do here, but that's pretty good. Anyway, yeah, lots of big stuff being announced here. Unbelievable. It's going to be interesting to see what if she talks at all about feature film stuff. Let's get back to it.
During our first year on Disney+, our animated series Star Wars: The Clone Wars saw tremendous success with its epic seventh and final season.
Are they bringing Clone Wars back?
Building on the legacy of The Clone Wars, our new animated series, The Bad Batch, follows the Specialist Commandos as they embark on new missions in a rapidly changing galaxy. This is The Bad Batch.
They call themselves the Bad Batch.
Rambo. Even big Clone Wars fans didn't really like, from what I heard from people who are big Clone Wars fans.
We reorganized into the First Galactic Empire.
Kind of a lot of even Clone Wars fans didn't like the Bad Batch episodes all that much, but who knows? Maybe they've got a great idea and it'll be fantastic.
Quite an impressive display.
Target. Interesting Tarkin cameo there. I'll give it that. Interesting Tarkin cameo.
Star Wars Visions will be a series of animated short films celebrating the Star Wars galaxy through the lens of the world's best anime creators.
That's excellent. This anthology interesting idea.
Collection will bring 10 fantastic visions from several of the leading Japanese anime studios.
That's a really cool
a fresh
idea.
And diverse cultural perspective to Star Wars. Lando Calrissian is the galaxy's smoothest, most notorious scoundrel.
What?
And he'll return in a brand new event series for Disney Plus. Justin Simien, creator of the critically acclaimed and hugely popular Dear White People, is developing the story with us now.
I know Justin.
A massive Star Wars fan himself, Justin has put together a reel to give you a sense of the style, tone, and irresistible swagger of our upcoming series, Lando.
Is this gonna be live action? Oh, okay, so they're put, oh, they're, okay, wait a second. Is this gonna be live action? Are they getting Donald Glover in for this? I didn't catch it. Is it live action or is it animated? If it's animated, I'm not so terribly interested. But if it's live action, really? Are they now, Justin? Just you know, Justin Simien's from Dear White People. That he used to be a publicist at one of the studios when I first moved to Los Angeles. I used to have to work with Justin because Justin was one of the publicists, and so whenever he was coordinating or I was doing stuff with going to any press events or junkets or screenings, whatever, Justin was one of the guys I always used to have to interact with. And he was able to make that jump from just being a publicist at the studios. Not that there's just a publicist. That's a huge, awesome job. But from being a publicist at a studio to then becoming a filmmaker. Of course, he did Dear White People, which became a massive hit. Then it became a series. And now he's doing Lando. Interesting. Again, I'm waiting to hear if this is going to be live action or animated. It's not that I'm not interested if it's animated. I would just be significantly more interested if this is going to be Donald Glover coming back. I thought Donald Glover did a great job playing Lando, to be honest with you, but let's get back to it here.
Leslie Headland, Emmy-nominated creator of the mind-bending series Russian Doll, is a boldly innovative filmmaker bringing her new Star Wars series to Disney Plus. The Acolyte is a mystery thriller that will take us into a galaxy of shadowy secrets and emerging dark side powers in the final days of the High Republic era.
So this is going to be in High Republic era.
As we continue to develop new stories,
interesting.
The intersection of animation and visual effects offers new opportunities for us to explore. Lucasfilm Animation will be teaming up with our unparalleled visual effects team, ILM, to develop a special Star Wars adventure for Disney Plus,
a droid story.
This epic journey will introduce us to a new hero guided by our most iconic duo, R2-D2 and C-3PO, on a special mission known only to them. What could possibly go wrong?
Okay, that could be interesting.
Outside of the Star Wars galaxy, we're expanding Lucasfilm's presence on Disney Plus with another beloved mythological world created by George Lucas, Willow. This series will be set decades after Ron Howard's 1988 movie, continuing the spirit of adventure, heroics, and humor of the original film.
Mad Monica.
We're delighted that Warwick Davis will be returning in the role of the great sorcerer, Willow Ufgood. We have a wonderful creative team at the helm. John Chu, director of the groundbreaking film Crazy Rich Asians, will be directing the pilot.
I like him.
Willow begins shooting next March in Wales and will debut on Disney Plus in 2022. Here's the team to share more.
And another thing. Okay, so we're getting Willow. We're getting Willow, so that's pretty cool. Listen, we got about a minute here, so let's go through some questions, some live questions and comments you guys have been sending in here. Lizzie McGuire, we already talked about that. Where do they have? Will Fox movies land on Hulu in the U.S.? Again, I think they probably will. Benson Price writes, now that Disney will have an adult section, do you think they could make rated MCU contents like an R-rated Blade? I don't know. I still don't think Bob Iger would approve it. That's the thing. I don't think Iger would approve R-rated MCU stuff because I don't think he wants to cause any confusion with the viewer base. But listen, with this new move they've been announcing today, Benson, I would have thought it's impossible before. But even though I still doubt Iger would allow it, it's possible. It's absolutely possible. I don't know that we need R-rated MCU stuff, but whatever. Elijah Neal writes, beyond excited, I mean, in the MCU, maybe outside of the MCU, like Deadpool, but who knows? Elijah writes, beyond excited for all the new Star Wars news they're going to get today. Been watching your show for a while, so this super chat is for all the years of great content you've been made. Thanks, man. And thank you for that. And we've already gotten huge amounts of Star Wars of Cassian, Obi-Wan, the Acolyte. That sounds amazing. They're going to be telling a story from a Sith point of view. That's crazy. New Republic, Rangers of the New Republic, Ahsoka Tano. I mean, they are just rolling it out right now. It's absolutely crazy. Thanks for writing that in, Elijah. 10 seconds left. Victor Garrity writes, over under 50%, we get an update on the Prince of Peace God of War series. Of course, Prince of Peace God of War is one of my movies that I made years ago. So no update on the series for that, Victor, but thanks for putting that in there. Appreciate that.
We also have some news to share on our theatrical slate.
Oh,
we're in pre-production on the next and final installment of Indiana Jones. At the helm, we have James Mangold, director of the Academy Award-winning film Ford vs. Ferrari. And of course, Indy himself, Harrison Ford, will be back to conclude this iconic character's journey.
I still don't believe they're going to make it.
Indy will begin shooting late spring of 2021 and will be released in July of 2022. Our slate is expanding further with a story that will introduce a new hero and explore an original world that feels perfectly paired with Lucasfilm storytelling.
What's this?
We're proud to bring to the screen author Tomi Adeyemi's New York Times best-selling novel, Children of Blood and Bone.
Oh, okay, no, we did talk about this on the
John Tanner
Show.
This story will center around a young African girl's heart-racing quest to restore magic to her forsaken people, the Magi. Tomi was recently included in the Time 100's list of most influential people of 2020. We're proud to be partnering with the 20th Century Studios on this coming-of-age adventure.
Nice.
Our Star Wars theatrical slate is pushing forward into a new future era. As we announced recently, we're currently developing a brand new Star Wars feature with acclaimed filmmaker Academy Award winner Taika Waititi.
I knew they talked about
Taika's approach to Star Wars will be fresh, unexpected, and unique. His enormous talent and sense of humor will ensure that audiences are in for an unforgettable ride. He's currently hard at work writing this next adventure. And to close today, I couldn't be more excited that our next Star Wars feature film will be directed by Patty Jenkins.
Patty,
director of the Wonder Woman franchise, will bring her inspired vision to Rogue Squadron. This story will introduce a new generation of starfighter pilots as they earn their wings and risk their lives in a boundary-pushing high-speed thrill ride. The legend of Rogue Squadron has been long beloved by Star Wars fans and will move us into a future era of the galaxy. Rogue Squadron will be released in theaters Christmas of 2023.
If theater still exists.
As you can see, this is
look
a new
at this.
Era for
Take
Star
a screenshot
Wars
of this, guys.
Film, with expanded opportunities for continued innovation, high-quality storytelling, and cinematic experiences like never before. And now, I'm pleased to introduce Courtney Monroe,
Good
president of National Geographic Content.
Okay, not as excited about National Geographic content, although they put out some good stuff.
Thank you, Kathy.
Hey, nice presentation.
National Geographic has been entertaining global
audiences. Okay, guys, I don't mean to be disrespectful to National Geographic. I don't mean to be, we'll keep them on here for a bit. But oh my God, what a lineup. What a lineup. Now, all these could end up being crap. Right? I mean, they go, but Patty Jenkins, you guys, if you guys have been watching my show for any period of time, you know I am 1,000% on board with Patty Jenkins. She is an incredible filmmaker. Her coming Rogue Squadron. I knew a lot of people from the Legends, people who like the Legends novels and things like that, have been wondering if we'd ever get to visit like a Rogue Squadron kind of thing again. And that's got to be exciting for a lot of people. So that is fantastic as well. And listen, again, no disrespect meaning to the National Geographic stuff, but I mean, I just think this is great. Again, I want to find out if this, Lando show is going to be live action or animated. I'm sure people who saw the sizzle know. I just don't know yet. If you guys know if they answered that in the sizzle or not, let us know. Interesting that there was no Boba Fett announcement. I really thought they would denounce a Boba Fett spinoff, but maybe they'll just use him more in The Mandalorian. Now, listen, while they're doing more National Geographic stuff and before we get over to the MCU, let's take some more of the live questions you guys have been sending in. Okay, the next one up is Vlogger Dude writes, do you think Disney Plus will end up on the Nintendo Switch? I don't think so. I mean, but I don't see why. There's no reason they need to have it on the Nintendo Switch. The Nintendo Switch isn't really a content delivery system per se, like the PS4 or the Xbox can be. So I'm going to guess no, but you never know. Interesting question, Vlogger Dude. Lynn Kwai Lucas writes, this intermission is going to give them time to prepare WB's coffin. Yeah, I'm sure WB is not liking what they're probably crapping their pants right now. Listen, I love WB. I got some great friends over at WB, but yeah, this is scary stuff for them. Josh Razakusis writes, thanks for letting us watch along with you, John. Well, thank you for watching along with me, guys. Squirtle Master Kenobi writes, here's your $10. Thank you so much, Squirtle. I appreciate that. Next up, we've got JJ Aguilar writes, Sony used to have a service called PS View. Yes, they did. They almost bought my show Movie Talk for PSU. Don't laugh. There were actually discussions about Sony buying my show Movie Talk back in the day and moving it onto PS View. So there was that. Where it had live TV and demand programming, it existed before the rest of the studio services, but they killed it. Likely they bring it back now with this new streaming climate, especially with all the announcements. When look, Sony probably already has plans, but when they see what's like Disney is doing today, when they see that stuff, it's got to motivate them to really kick into gear their own streaming platform. I mean, they just announced Crunchyroll along with owning Crackle. Maybe something. Listen, the PS5 gives them their own native streaming platform, right? So it gives them their own streaming platform. So maybe it's something they should absolutely look into doing, JJ, if they're not already planning on it. All right. Glenn Taylor writes, when the blonde lady talks about the power of Hulu, it reminds me of the power of the pyramid pitch from The Office. I remember that. Jim's speech was much better. Yeah, none of these presenters have a lot of charisma. Like none of them are Apple. Like the Apple people do this sort of thing way better. They really do. So you're right. Jim's speech was better. Anthony Francisco writes, will Disney buy more companies and merge it with Disney Plus? Plus greetings from the Netherlands. It's possible. I mean, I think Disney is always in, they're still on the National Geographic stuff. Disney is always in acquisition mode right now. They're not in as big of a place of acquisition right now because they did just spend $73 billion to buy Fox, which was like half of their estimated company value. And we're starting to see in this presentation why they bought Fox. It was never about X-Men. It was always about this huge library of content and all the IP. And earlier in today's show, we saw them in today's streaming. We've seen how they're going to be implementing all that. And it's really interesting and really fascinating. So maybe in the future, I don't think we'll hear about them acquiring anything else in the immediate future, though. I just don't know that they have the wiggle room in their coffers to do it right now. But we will see. All right, next up. Lotion writes, Hydra infiltrated Disney? Probably. It kind of looks like that a bit, doesn't it? All right, Helio Dragonheart writes, just sent us a super chat. Thank you, Helio. Red Hero writes, John, did you hear Justin Chatwin is set to reprise his role as Goku In Spider-Man 3. I have not heard anything, but again, it would all depends on where you're hearing that from. Is it from one of the actual major trades or is it from someplace else? I'll look into that later. Daniel Vasquez writes, this reminds me of the loading screens in Sonic 6. Oh, the waits. Raphael Miranda writes, quality versus quantity, shade to Netflix. You know what? You're not wrong. When Iger came out and said, we are about quality content, not quantity of content, that was a not so veiled slam on Netflix. I mean, don't let anybody tell you different. You are absolutely right. That was a not so veiled attack on Netflix. It really, really was. But listen, it's not like Disney Plus hasn't made a bunch of filler content too. They have. Be Our Chef. Workshop or whatever it's called, shop class. You know, they have their own amount, but not nearly as much as Netflix does. So I think you're right. I think that was probably a direct kind of slam on Netflix. All right, next up, Darth So writes, will physical media go away now? I mean, it physical media has already been in the process of going away for years. Their sales have dropped like a rock year over year for a long time. So it's already on the way out the door, but this type of stuff will just hasten its way out the door. I'm not saying it should. I'm just saying it is. Taylor Bren writes, probably only get sizzle reel with special URL. Probably. Yeah. But all that sizzle reel stuff, I'm sure is going to be available on YouTube here and online here pretty soon. Micah T writes, John, I read an article today that only investors get to see the content. Yeah. But I'm betting it's going to be online here pretty fast if it's not already online already. Empire Fan 1980 writes, can you imagine all the Star Wars fans going crazy if they announce Kathleen Kennedy stepping down? Now, hey, listen, believe it or not, a lot of Star Wars fans are very much on Kathleen Kennedy's side. Not the vocal bunch, but a lot of them are. But I still predict within the year. I said before today's show started, I stand by it. I think within the year she'll step down. And I think Kathleen Kennedy is a fabulous, fabulous producer, one of the best in Hollywood history. But she hasn't done a great job as a studio head. And you know, she's definitely got some big wins. $3-4 billion films. She put out Mandalorian, like all that kind of stuff. Good on her. So she'll be able to take that a feather and cap. But I still believe within a year she will step down. All right. Shoot. Is it time to go back over? No, they're still on. The National Geographic stuff. All right. Let's get a couple more questions. Ramon just sends in a super chat. Thank you, Ramon. Evan. Sil Imediso writes, Kate McKinnon with her crazy eyes. Oh, what's she going to do next with those crazy eyes? I know with that new show they're going to do on Hulu. Those are some crazy eyes. I am very much looking forward to seeing what they're going to do, to seeing those sizzle reels of the shows they were previewing earlier, like the Martin Short and Steve Martin one. I am very curious about those. So I want to see those. David Rosen just sends in a super chat. Thank you, David Rosen. Amy Novice, Judith Light. Remember I was saying the Hulu lady, she looks like the mom from, Who's the Boss? Judith Light. Thank you, Anime Novice. I appreciate. Yes, that was her name. Thank you. I froze on her name. Justin McCalla writes, They warned that some content couldn't be broadcast because of copyright. YouTube probably would have hammered your channel if it aired anyway. Probably, yes. But like I said, I do suspect that if it's not already up on YouTube, it will all be on YouTube here pretty soon. It looks like National Geographic's got some sort of Hemsworth Brothers travel show. Kind of going off, Netflix has a couple of travel shows with some celebrities. So it looks like National Geographic is going on that as well at the Hemsworths. I love Chris Hemsworth. I'm not afraid to say it. I love Chris Hemsworth. All right. Are they getting back into the other material now? Let's see. Nope. More National Geographic stuff. Okay. Let's get in one more. Jonathan Holt writes, what are your thoughts on Bob Iger saying that their focus will be on quality, not quantity? This has been a big fear when it comes to streaming. Thanks. Yeah, listen, I will still kind of believe it when I see it. And Will Smith's doing a National Geographic show. Look at that. I'll still kind of believe it when I see it. I do believe they will still continue to put out a lot of filler content, but probably not to the nearly to the same degree that a Netflix does. But hearing him say we're going to focus on quality, that's big. Look at the Star Wars lineup we just saw. That Star Wars lineup was really impressive. Now let's see if they actually turn around and execute it into something really good. But if they do the same thing now, if they put up MCU and give us some great announcements like that, I mean, it is pop. Listen, I was expecting big things today. This has already been bigger, more major, more stuff announced. I'm talking even before they started talking Star Wars, like even with all the Hulu stuff, the FX stuff, just the business stuff of the way they're going to be handling putting Star into Disney Plus and all that kind of, this has been huge, guys. This has been absolutely huge. All right. Joshua Tabak writes, do you think we will hear anything on Moon Knight? Oh, I do. I 100% believe we will hear something about Moon Knight. I don't see how they can. Now, it might not be a lot. They might not have a sizzle or anything like it, but I do believe you'll hear them at least mention Moon Knight to some degree. I think it's something they absolutely have to do. Okay, next up, we've got Mad World Production Rights. By the way, guys, in case you're wondering, we're just waiting for them to get past the National Geographic stuff. No disrespect intended to the National Geographic people whatsoever. I like a lot of National Geographic stuff, but we're just going to take this time instead to take some of the live comments that came in. Mad World Productions writes, they stole the Trim Legacy effects. ILM, I'm not quite sure what the Trim Legacy effects are, but they've been doing a lot. They've put a lot of production effort in today's live stream, that's for sure. Stubble McShave writes, my thoughts, Star replaces Hulu in countries that have Disney Plus but not Hulu. Star Plus have shows from Hulu and Disney Plus in countries that doesn't have Disney Plus. No Star for US. Listen, I know there's been some confusion going around here, and I'm part of the confused, but it was sounding to me like Star is going to become one of the sections on Disney Plus. That's what it sounded like to me, but maybe it was just to places. Star was going to be added to places. Wait a second, what's going on here? What are they doing here right now? Why are they talking about Simpsons?
Hello for? Again. I'm so happy to be back talking about Disney Plus. All of us have loved developing for it, but only one of us has actually been living on it. So I've traveled all the way to Springfield, still don't know what state I'm in, to talk to a member of our studio family for 30 years, Mr. Homer Simpson.
I don't care what everybody thinks about Simpsons.
So,
I still
Homer,
love The Simpsons.
What have you learned about Disney Plus this year?
Oh, wait, I didn't know there'd be a test. Well, I've learned how to find plus on my keyboard, and I've learned that armed bounty hunters make excellent nannies. And if you don't mind some creative criticism, live-action Aladdin is a total ripoff of this cartoon I saw called Disney's Aladdin. Frozen is not about my credit cards. I would kill for Fat Thor's body. Snow White finally exposes the dangers of eating apples. And in conclusion, Pixar is run by a jumping lamp. Now I'm going to throw it back to Dana, who's going to tell you about all the great new projects that are going to be developed by the powerful television studios for Disney Plus. Allow me one personal note. I was promised beer, and if I don't get it soon, I'm taking this guy with me.
Okay, well
I
done.
I want to thank Homer and his family for
Judith
helping
Light
to make Disney Plus such a success. The Simpsons is one of the top titles on the platform in every country where it's launched so far. Yeah. Now here's our development of Disney Plus Originals.
All right.
We have an expansive slate of family entertainment, from comedies to epic dramas. Shows that speak to a global audience executed by great creators.
Now will this speak
people
quantity
who know how to
or quality?
Big hits. You'll see that a number are based on iconic IP from the Disney library. These are titles that are beloved. They're trusted by families, passed down through generations. It's a creator's dream to have access to them and gives us a real competitive edge. And I'll start with this one. The Mighty Ducks is the iconic movie that led to sequels,
really?
An animated series,
and
a Stanley Cup
Ducks?
Winning hockey team. The next installment, The Mighty Ducks Game Changers. We'll pick the story back
know.
Up with a familiar face, lots of heart and humor, and kids who can really skate.
I don't know, maybe some of you guys are looking forward to it. Emilio Estevez has got to be in it.
Are we ducks or what?
When
he's not doing anything
you're
else.
You're working on the Mighty Ducks reboot. It needs no further introduction.
Yep.
We're going to make a lot of people really happy.
The Ducks are a powerhouse organization. The record 10 state championships. A little different than the Ducks of the 90s.
Sunscreen, sunscreen.
You know we play indoors, right?
Scrimmage, now let's go.
I recognize a lot of performers.
If you can't be great at hockey, it's like, don't bother.
Shouldn't kids be able to play sports for fun?
Stephanie, you brought two private trainers to your kids' hockey practice.
I'm a pediatric sports psychologist.
Okay, let's start our own team. I want you to think about all the other kids who've been told that they're too small
Lisa's rocking
too
a Toronto Maple Leaf jersey.
Good.
No,
I agree. I would not be an acid physically. I have more of a podcast body.
I have 24 hours to find a coach.
You lost? So if you're looking at red skates, that's up front.
My mom doesn't seem to care for any good or not. I don't think the other kids care either.
Yeah, you know who else doesn't care? This guy.
Wait, which guy?
This guy?
You gotta be more specific.
How are you not getting this? You gotta make this happen for yourself.
Let's do this.
Why does Emilio Estevez look like he's only aged 3 years?
Why do you care so much?
Because you care. It's not over yet.
But it'll get the Gilmore Girls audience, if nothing else. I can't pretend I'm interested, but I'm sure a lot of people will be.
Turner and Hooch is a charming buddy comedy.
Turner and
it
Hooch?
It stars Josh Peck in the role made famous by Tom Hanks.
Okay, guys, I'm going to keep this on,
Josh,
but I'm going to run and
I
use
bet
the
your
bathroom.
Kids do.
Because,
his partner here
yeah,
is
I've been
a
doing this for a couple hours
mascot.
Now, so I got to run and use the bathroom. I'll be right back. I'll be right back. Again, not all that interested in Turner and Hooch. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not all that interested in Turner and Hooch. Or Mighty Ducks. But I know, like I said, the Gilmore Girls, Anne will be interested. My wife Anne loves Gilmore Girls. So, all right, let's get back to it here.
Big Shot is an original concept from David E. Kelley. It's a celebration of girl power set in the world of high school basketball. No one creates authentic relationships quite like David. And few TV stars are as recognizable as this one.
Kelley is an incredible television maker.
I found something. It's not college.
You need a second chance.
Oh.
This is the only one I could get.
It's Uncle Whatever from
it's
Full
high
House.
School.
Tim, I can't coach a bunch of rich private school boys in California.
Girls. It's a girls' school.
Coach Marvin Korn is going from the NCAA to some fancy girls' high school?
Personally, I think it's all a big mistake, but I'm prepared to make the best of it.
Oh,
do not
from Community.
Screw this up.
Holly Barrett, assistant coach.
Marvin Korn, any advice?
Some of them can be a bit much.
I'm sorry, are you chewing gum?
This is Westbrook. We won't respond to my way or the highway.
I'm going to teach you my system of basketball from the ground up. Smaller steps, but faster.
I figured it'd be rough, but this is next level. If we all just quit, they fire him. I think he wants to be a good person.
When they said you were coming, that meant something. I was excited.
All I care about is basketball. It's about making my father proud.
After watching you play, I truly believe that we could do something special. We're just getting started.
I wanna be
you're connecting with these girls.
Oh, stop it.
I don't know, this isn't getting me either.
I just wanted to say thank you for caring.
We do this not because right. It is easy, but because it is hard. If you try your very best, then you have the potential
I like the
to be
clothesline.
Great.
I'll be honest with you. So far, this segment, they're 0-3 with me. I'm not that into the idea of Mighty Ducks. I'm not into Turner and Hooch, and this hasn't got my attention either. So, I don't know. We'll see. All right, what else you got?
Big, fun, character-based series like these are one segment of our content strategy. The other, dramas that are ambitious in scale that will be brought to life by A-list talent. I'll start with three projects in development. Beauty and the Beast expands the universe of the blockbuster film, more than $1 billion in worldwide box office. LeFou and Gaston return.
Oh, that's right, the LeFou and Gaston thing. I am interested
Luke
in this.
Evans and Josh Gad. with all new music composed by Oscar Grammy Oscar,
I thought they were both great in the movie. I really did. Okay, so we got some more time to kill here. I really did like them in the Beauty and the Beast movie. I didn't think the Beauty and the Beast movie was as good as the animated version, but I thought it was pretty good, and they did some interesting things. Let me fire in one or two quick questions here while we're thought. Okay, that was stubble. Wakanda Forever writes, Disney rules the world. Now all they need is DC. Yeah, maybe pretty soon Disney buys DC and puts it on Hulu Plus or Disney Plus. JJ Lee writes, looks like Star Plus Latin America equals to Hulu in the U.S., home for 18 plus Fox content separated from D plus. Everywhere else, Star is that home and attached to Disney Plus. That's what it looks like to me, JJ. I mean, that's what it looks like to me on the surface at any rate. But again, it's a little bit confusing. I might have missed a step in there. We'll certainly find more out and look more into this a little bit later. Luke Dennis sends in a super chat to be supportive. Thank you, Luke. Scott Purdy writes, hey, John, maybe Bo will be on the Ahsoka show. I mean, that's also that's a good thought there. Maybe Bo-Katan will be used, but she's going to be a supporting character in the Ahsoka Tano show. We will find out. Let's get back to it.
Swiss Family Robinson reimagines the classic story.
That
this
could be
interesting. This is a collaboration between Ron Moore, the creator of Global Smash's Battlestar Galactica
and Ronald D. Moore, my favorite show of all time.
And John Chu, the director of Crazy Rich Asians. As you just heard, he's also directing Willow. Percy Jackson and the Olympians is one of the most popular books in the world.
They are doing more Percy Jackson. Okay.
It sold more than 70 million copies in 35 countries.
Were you guys expecting them to announce as much stuff as they are today? I was not expecting this much. This is crazy.
It drove more than a million tweets in the first 24 hours. And the final project I want to share is based on the international best-selling book series, The Mysterious Benedict Society. Time magazine called it one of the best young adult books of all time.
There is a place where truth matters, even if most people don't pay attention to it. Our organization is always searching for those who appreciate the truth.
If any child is caught cheating,
oh, I like
they
her.
Will be executed.
Okay, I like that line. The line was funny.
And our criteria for approval may be considered mysterious.
Mr. Benedict, we have our team.
Hello?
I'm the aforementioned Mr. Benedict.
You all possess a quality that is lacking in our society.
Reigning your intuitive understanding of human nature.
Sticky your reservoir of knowledge.
Constance.
The refines of conventional thought patterns.
Hey, you're uncanny. This looks whimsical.
What is it that you all have in common?
I'm getting into this a little bit.
And bad fashion.
You're very unpleasant.
Okay. You're the only ones capable of seeing the truth, and together you are immensely powerful.
We're asking you to go on a mission that can only be accomplished by children.
There is a sinister force brainwashing us. And yes, he is my twin brother.
A little silly, but...
So, you need
I'll check
a
bunch it out.
Of smart
I'll give it a chance.
Orphans to do a deadly mission. I get it.
Ideally not deadly.
I'll check it out. That one has a little bit of appeal.
And this is just the beginning. We have a deep bench of talent and the opportunity to access the incredible Disney library. We're looking forward to creating many
Some
more
hits
Disney
and misses
Plus
there.
Originals in
Some
the years
hits and
ahead.
Misses, but all right.
And now it's my pleasure to introduce Sean Bailey, president of Walt Disney Studios Motion Pictures Production.
Okay, so Walt Disney proper here. Let's see what they're going to be talking about.
Wonderful stuff from Dana and her team. Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, there are so many incredible dimensions to this company, and my team and I have the honor of getting to focus on a treasure trove of iconic characters and stories that spring from the Disney imagination as we continue to build on Disney's singular legacy of creating magic for audiences worldwide. We have a lot of fun diving into our expansive library spanning nearly 100 years. To bring beloved tales to life in new ways for today's viewers. The addition, since last year, of great franchise IP created out of 20th Century Studios means an even bigger sandbox to play in.
Yeah, that's
one
why
of
they
the truly
it.
Exciting things about Disney Plus is the opportunity it has given us to greatly expand our storytelling across a variety of genres to bring compelling, original films from all around the world to the screen in a way that only Disney can. We have a ton of projects in the works, and I have the pleasure of taking you on a tour through the magical and memorable stories we're producing.
All right, give it to us.
Disney Plus is already home to a massive collection of unforgettable movies from across the decades. The kind of movies you want to watch again and again with your family and friends. We're right in the middle of the holiday season, and I'm sure, like me, you and your families have your favorite must-watch movies for every season.
All these are about to announce going to be for Disney Plus.
On Disney Plus, we're continuing to create new holiday memories for fans and families around the world with such films as The Delightful Noelle and the brand new Godmother.
Noelle was awful.
Of course,
Noelle
one of the most popular holidays is Halloween. And one of the most popular Halloween movies is the cult classic, Hocus Pocus. And I'm happy to confirm, we are working on a treat for Disney Plus audiences with a spooky sequel. In addition to Disney and 20th
Century, why does he
Century,
have to walk into frame? This
we also have films from the Touchstone days that fit right in the Disney Plus wheelhouse. One such project we're excited about is a modern take on the hilarious 80s comedy, Three Men and a Baby.
Okay, I heard they might be doing this.
We are deep in development, aiming for a 2022 release, and we could not be more thrilled to have Disney all-star Zac Efron attached to star.
That's right.
Now, we also love to tell real-life stories of heroes from around the world. Distinctly human stories that draw on emotion, inspiration, and aspiration, like Togo, which we premiered last year.
A lot of people like that.
Safety is inspired by the empowering story of Clemson University football player Ray McElrathby, who found himself raising his 11-year-old brother while still in college. This uplifting drama from Marshall director Reggie Hudlin debuts on Disney Plus tomorrow. We are also working on a film based on the incredible story of Kenan Lowe, a high school coach who averted tragedy through compassion, with the man of many talents, Dwayne Johnson, on board as a producer. Meanwhile, heading into production
next
year.
Although I am a sucker for true stories.
Greek Freak is the remarkable story of NBA star Giannis Antetokounmpo and his family as they lifted themselves out of poverty as undocumented immigrants.
I always just say Giannis because Antetokounmpo, I always trip over his name.
With Giannis ultimately finding himself on the world stage. And I can confirm we are developing a biographical film for Disney Plus with another NBA superstar, Chris Paul, whose past includes a deeply moving story
I'm the new
of
Chris
family,
Paul.
Legacy, and destiny that helped make him who he is today.
As I love you can Chris tell, Paul.
I do watch a fair amount of ESPN myself. Moving to another of our favorite genres, children's and young adult books certainly aren't just for kids.
They yes,
speak
they are.
To the kid in all of us, and they have the power to shape our understanding of the world.
I'm not expecting to be loved this section.
Flora and Ulysses.
Not interested.
It's based on a Newbery Medal winning book about the misadventures of cynical young
comic
book fan Flora.
I'm not the target audience, obviously.
And her super-powered squirrel sidekick, Ulysses. Flora
That's cute.
And Ulysses will debut on Disney Plus this coming February. A little further ahead on the slate, for 2022, we are reimagining the hit comedy Cheaper by the Dozen with Blackish producer Kenya Barris. It's centered around a multiracial blended family of 12. Navigating a hectic home life while managing their family business.
Okay.
I'm thrilled to share that Gabrielle Union is set to star in this reboot.
Oh, I love Gabrielle
and
Union.
We're revisiting the beloved Diary of a Wimpy Kid series, which has spawned a successful live-action film franchise from the books.
I never understood the appeal. I watched
the series remains as popular as ever.
I'm not quite clear why anybody likes those, but whatever.
The latest Wimpy Kid book,
it's all subjective.
Released in October, was an instant New York Times bestseller. In our new film, our intrepid hero, Greg Heffley, gets an all-new look, and he's, well, a little animated about it. In expanding our focus on content development for streaming, we think there are some great worlds and stories, separate from the amazing original work coming out of our animation studios, that we can tap into in a new way, particularly from the world of 20th Century Studios.
My wife
the Ice
is working,
Age series
and yet
has
she's
so
still
far seen five feature
drink,
films
she's sure,
to the tune of
to
over
$3.2
billion at the global box office. We are now in production on a spin-off film exclusively for Disney Plus called The Ice Age Adventures of Buck Wild. It centers on three series favorites.
There.
The prankster Possum Brothers, Crash and Eddie.
I mean, I've never been huge on the Ice Age movies, but I know a lot of people who really were, so this could work.
I'm pleased to announce that the wonderful Simon Pegg will be returning in the role of Buck.
So you got Simon
Pegg moving to another popular film series that has earned a combined $1.3 billion at the global box office across three films. We are ready to spend another night at the museum.
Animated.
In a fun twist, it is animated this time around, which gives us even more leeway to stretch the imagination with this fantastical premise.
That's an interesting
move. We are thrilled to have Shawn Levy, who has helped shape this blockbuster franchise as director of the previous films, on board as a producer. Now, I'm excited to shift gears into some of the event titles we have in the works.
All right.
These are films born out of some of the most iconic and enduring stories and characters in the Disney canon. As with Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Maleficent, Mulan, and Lady and the Tramp, these are worlds and characters we love, reimagined and brought to life by visionary filmmakers and top talent. And we create these stories at a size,
like a politician,
scale, and quality that is second to none, regardless of the size of the screen. We have an extraordinary slate of upcoming tentpole films.
Great.
And I will give you a quick glimpse today of just a few.
All right, what do we got here? Jungle Cruise.
In July 2021, we invite audiences to embark on Jungle Cruise with an adventure of mythic proportions in the grand tradition of Pirates of the Caribbean. It stars two of today's biggest movie stars, Dwayne Johnson and Emily Blunt. And it strikes the perfect balance.
I saw a bunch of preview material
stakes,
this at D23
gigantic action and plenty
a long time ago. And it could be interesting. It could work.
When it comes to having it all, drama, comedy, action, emotion, music, for audiences worldwide, there is perhaps nothing like The Lion King. Following the $1.6 billion success of our 2019 reimagining,
oh my goodness,
we are in development on an inspired prequel of sorts that revisits these iconic characters.
A prequel of sorts.
And I am beyond thrilled that we have Barry Jenkins of the Oscar-winning Moonlight
in
the director's chair.
I remember them talking about this.
A couple years ago, Mary Poppins Returns had audiences tapping their, what do you call them? Oh,
Mary Poppins was not good.
And director Rob Marshall is back in the Disney fold to bring his unique gifts to a live-action take on The Little Mermaid.
Yeah, we've been expecting this.
In the title role, we have multi-talented singer and actor Halle Bailey, alongside a phenomenal cast that
not
includes
Halle
Aquafina,
Berry, Halle
David Diggs,
Bailey,
Jacob Tremblay, Melissa McCarthy, and Javier Bardem. And we will have not only the beloved Menken Ashman songs from the animated original, but some all-new music from Alan Menken and Lin-Manuel Miranda. For Disney Plus, we're currently in development on a hybrid live-action animated feature with two perennial favorites in Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers. Pop stars Akiva Schaffer directs,
The
hilarious John Mulaney and Andy Samberg
are set to star
in the title roles. Seth Rogen will cameo, and you'll be sure to recognize his voice in this early animation test we are sharing with you today. In our film, cartoons are living among us in all their animated forms. And let's just say, Dale may have gone a little overboard to keep up with the current popularity of CGI.
Okay, so a little break here. Okay, let's not totally thrilled so far with what I'm seeing from the Disney studios, but some of the stuff that we've already heard before. Let's get over and keep taking some of the questions here. Well, we've got a minute and 30 here. Josh Ward writes, is stagecraft more effective than green screen? It's different, right? Stagecraft is good for certain things, environments, things like that. But there's a number of things where it can't replace CG. It's just a different new tool that gives them some flexibility. Norwegian Kryptonia writes, Disney Plus just did a KO on HBO Max. Yeah, I mean, listen, I love HBO Max. I really do, but they are making some huge announcements here, no doubt about it. Luke Dennis writes, is UK getting stars? We aren't part of Europe. That part wasn't really clear. I didn't really get a clear idea about which way they were going with that, but let's keep our eyes open on that. Good question, Luke. Cyclops is better than Wolverine writes, do you think we'll get any X-Men news today? I don't. But they might, but I'm not expecting that we will. Not yet. I think there's just too much other stuff to announce, but we'll find out soon. Digipak writes, looks like future Star Wars movies will no longer have a Star Wars story titles. Oh, I'm so glad about that. I hated that. A Star Wars story. I've never liked that in the first place. So you're right, Digi. It looks like they're moving away from that, thankfully. Big Head Daryl writes, I've never watched Star Wars. Is Mandalorian a good start? I'm a huge fan. I've been watching your content since the AMC days. Thank you. Listen, the nice thing about Mandalorian, you can just jump in a Mandalorian if you want and you'll be fine. I would suggest at least watching the original trilogy because they are amongst the greatest films of all time. So I think you can, but I think you're fine if you want to just jump right in Mandalorian. I think it's good enough, but I think you'll be served well if you do try and go back and watch the original trilogy first. All right, let's get back to it.
Rescue Rangers is slated for spring 2022. It is no lie to say this next tale is one of the all-time classics. Pinocchio brought us not only the plucky puppet and his cautious
cricket, but also some
of the most iconic Disney music of all time. From I've Got No Strings to the quintessential When You Wish Upon a Star. And now, especially for Disney Plus, we are working with the famed director, Robert Zemeckis, who is pulling the strings on a compelling new live-action retelling with the one and only Tom Hanks set to star. We will be leveraging state-of-the-art CGI to bring Pinocchio to life. Oh. Like Pinocchio, the story of Peter Pan and Neverland has always had a special appeal to audiences. David Lowery, who did such a spectacular job on Pete's Dragon, is exploring a new angle in Peter Pan and Wendy just for Disney Plus. And we are putting together an amazing cast, including Yara Shahidi in the role of Tinkerbell and Jude Law as Captain Hook.
I didn't hear that.
An update on a project that's been eagerly awaited for some time. We have been working on a sequel to the hit film Enchanted, which starred Amy Adams as Giselle.
Yeah, I heard about this.
Who finds her
Enchanted's
life flipped
really
upside
good,
down when she falls out of her animated fantasy world and finds herself stuck in real life Manhattan. We could not be any more thrilled to share that Amy will be back as Giselle in this sequel.
I heard that wasn't official yet, but I guess it's official now.
Which will stream exclusively on Disney Plus.
Nice. All right.
One more exciting tidbit of news. We are in development on a third film in the beloved Sister Act series with none other than Whoopi Goldberg herself on board to star and produce. Tyler Perry is also signed on as a producer on the project.
Who was asking for another Sister Act
movie? And we will have more details on these titles in the coming months.
No, not me.
As you can see,
whatever.
We have a huge range of exciting projects in the works across live action and animation and somewhere in between. Now, I haven't shown a lot of footage today because many of these projects are still in development or pre-production. So I want to close out with something really special for you from a film that's a little further along and that we could not be more excited about. Cruella dives into the rebellious early days of one of the most notorious and notoriously fashionable villains, the legendary Cruella de Vil. Oscar winner Emma Stone stars as Estella,
she does
aka
look good.
Cruella.
She looks really good.
Opposite Oscar winner Emma Thompson as the Baroness, the head of a prestigious fashion house who plucks Estella from obscurity as a burgeoning designer. It's set against the backdrop of 1970s punk rock London, and our director Craig Gillespie delivers a truly unique take on this one-of-a-kind villain.
Are they going to show us the footage?
Today, I have a never-before-seen sizzle that will give you a real flavor of this fantastic film.
Will they actually
show enjoy.
Us? Nope, they're not going to show us, which is it's fine. Okay. Again, a mixed reaction to what they're showing us there so far. That's fine. Okay, let's get through one or two questions here. Let's see. Chazzy writes, will they talk about X-Men and Fantastic Four again? I don't think they will, but you never know. And I think we're going to find out here in just a couple of minutes. Iconic Reaction writes, excuse me while I viciously masturbate to the thought that we will see Hayden in a Vader suit. Also, this is random, but I concur. I consider you to be a father to me. Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Oh, that's right. I got the timeline mixed up about when Obi-Wan is happening. Obviously, Vader is still alive. I was saying, what's okay? Hayden's going to be a Force ghost? I totally got the timeline mixed up in my head. At any rate, that is really interesting news. I think it's going to make a lot of people very excited, Iconic Reaction. So, I'm happy for everybody who's going to be happy. Good Canadian kid. And thanks for watching along, Iconic. Ty C. writes, how close do you think Disney Plus is to 100 million subs? Well, they said a little bit earlier in the broadcast, they are now at 86 million. So they're closing in. 86 million, which is crazy. One of my most excited things, James Argento writes, Patty released a video on Twitter on why she chose Rogue Squadron. I am so excited. I love Patty Jenkins. I am so excited she's going to be doing this. And okay, let's get back to it here.
All these projects soon. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Okay, now is it Marvel time?
Hi, it's Lowell. Let me offer a big thanks to Sean. And we're now going to give you another chance to stretch your legs.
All right.
Since Hanukkah starts tonight, we wish those who are celebrating a happy Hanukkah. And if you're interested, during this break, feel free to enjoy this great new Disney Channel Hanukkah video with music from David Diggs with William Hudson and Jonathan Snipes. We'll resume in about 5 minutes with presentations from Walt Disney.
They're going to give us 5 minutes, so let's spend the next 5 minutes. Guy, I am overloaded. I am completely overloaded by how much they have already given us, and we haven't even gotten to the MCU stuff yet. Absolutely unbelievable from a business point of view. The Hulu strategy, the FX stuff, the Disney Plus stuff, all the Star Wars stuff, all the animation stuff, all the, oh my God, this has been huge. All right, let's get over and start taking some more questions, guys, while we're on this little bit of a break. And yes, again, Patty Jenkins, I'm so excited about this. Cannot wait to see what they're going to do with that. Daniel Higgins writes, would you purchase one share in Disney just to see the whole investor meeting? Yeah, I probably would have. Really, it's not a bad idea to invest in Disney as it is anyway. All right, Darth Impact writes, with the success of The Mandalorian and the last three sequel films doing so with critics, should Disney retcon episodes 7, 8, and 9 in your thoughts? Nope, they're canon. Just like I hate the prequels, but ask me if I think they should retcon the prequels. No way in hell. You don't retcon Star Wars. You don't retcon Star Wars. Not the canon stuff. The legend stuff you can retcon because it was never canon in the first place. Not to mention, The Force Awakens was not so-so with critics. The critics loved it. The audiences loved it. I think it's awesome. The other ones did so-so. Don't even talk to me about The Rise of Skywalker. I didn't like that one at all. But nope, you do not retcon them. You do not retcon them at all. Just like I say, you should never retcon the prequels. All right, Tony White writes, no Mandalorian 3 or Pedro Pascal rumors true? Nah. Listen, I have no doubt like that there could have been some on set whatever, but these rumors about he walked off the show, don't believe any of that. And they've already announced a while ago that they've already greenlit season 3, so I guess they just didn't feel the need to talk about it in this thing. Not to mention, even if, for whatever reason, Pedro Pascal had left, they could just do Mandalorian without him. It's because you never see him anyway. ZMG Ruler writes, do you think Simpsons movie sequel will happen? I do, but the guy who runs the Simpsons has already said before that he will not do another Simpsons movie until they're done with the show. He said doing the last Simpsons movie while also producing the show at the same time, he said, was just unbearable. He said it was just too much. So I do believe we will get a Simpsons movie sequel, but not until after the show is done its television run. Christopher Harris writes, Disney saw Netflix's success with Cobra Kai. The Mighty Ducks is Disney's answer to it. Not surprised at all. Oh, no. Disney doesn't. Here's the thing about Disney. For good or for bad, because there are bad sides to this, Disney does not react to what other people do. They don't. It's not like Cobra Kai was the first old property that's been brought back to a modern thing, right? It's been done before. It'll be done again. So no, that wasn't them reacting to Netflix. Not in the least. By the way, did you see the trailer for Cobra Kai season 3? I don't even like Cobra Kai, but I thought the trailer for season 3 looked really good. I might have to jump back on it. All right. A-Rod 2006 writes, Hayden is back. Hashtag Darth Vader. I mean, that's going to make a lot of people very excited. Matthew Gerardo writes, Darth Plagueis in some form in The Acolyte. Ooh, wouldn't that be exciting? I'm going to guess no. But man, this whole notion of doing a story from a Sith apprentice's point of view, that's so cool. That's not something I think that I thought they would ever do. And the fact that they are doing it, I think sounds tremendously exciting. Lady Celtic Moon writes, for the wife bringing in the drink question, where's mine? LL. Yeah, I mean, Anne is great. I was, you know, we've been doing this broadcast now for over 2 hours, 2.5 hours, getting close to 3. And I had run out of drink and I texted Anne quick. I said, can you please bring me something to drink? And she, even though she's in the middle of work herself, my wife, ladies and gentlemen, she stopped, went down and got me a drink so I could keep on going. Isn't she awesome? All right. Next up, McLovin writes, Jacob is coming for you. I don't know what Jacob is. Lonzo Big Rex writes, Disney needs to do Gargoyles. It was such a good show. You know, I was never big on Gargoyles. We're 1 minute and 51 seconds away, guys, from coming back, probably for Marvel. You see the countdown clock there in the corner, 1:46. I liked Gargoyles. I'm not one of these guys that's ever thought, oh, we need a Gargoyle show. But you are not alone, Lonzo. I've heard from a lot of people over the years who have really wanted to see Gargoyles return in some sort of modern way, shape, or form, whether it's animated or live action. So while it's, I'm not one of the people who's really been yelling for it, a lot of people have over the years, and I wouldn't be surprised, probably not today, but I wouldn't be surprised if at some point in the near future, we do see them do something for Gargoyles. Let's see here. Sorry, just a quick little problem. All right. Next up, give me National Treasure 3 with Nick Cage wearing the bear suit from Wicker Man. Hey, listen, there was some talk earlier, you know, a couple of months ago, we talked about the fact that the producers of National Treasure 3 have said there's still talks. They're still trying to get one done. And I don't be surprised if within the next calendar year, if we don't hear an actual something official, because they say they're still working on it. It's still alive. It's still alive. It could happen. Digit Crypt writes, imagine they remake Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Hey, listen, this one thing they just talked about sounds pretty much in vain with that. But again, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? I wouldn't doubt at all if they revisit that at some point in the near future. Jose Munoz writes, hey, John, love your show. We're 25 seconds out. Love your show. Do you think we could ever see a Kingdom Hearts series in Disney Plus, or is that too niche? I don't think it's too niche. They love tapping into that those types of properties. So I don't see why that would be off the table. I don't think it would be off the table at all. It is absolutely something that could be considered at that point. All right, guys, we're coming back. I'm guessing we're about to get into Marvel. So let's see where we're at here. What are we looking at?
Welcome to the Kingdom of Kumandra, the setting of our next feature film, Raya and the Last Dragon.
I am excited for this.
Taking inspiration from the incredible cultures and lands of Southeast Asia, the team at Walt Disney Animation Studios has created a fantasy world like no other. Raya is a film about a lone warrior who brings together an unlikely gang of sworn enemies on a mission to unite the kingdom. There's
I saw the preview for this at D23. It does look awesome. It looks
fantastic. The street-savvy entrepreneur named Boon, the formidable giant Tong, and a little thieving toddler, Noi, with her band of Ongis. Their only hope is a magical, mythical, self-deprecating dragon named Sisu. With time running out, can they rebuild their shattered world? Led by the indomitable Kelly Marie Tran as Raya, and the one and only Awkwafina as a dragon like you've never seen before.
By the way, Kelly Marie Tran was not supposed to be the voice of Raya. They had another actress at D23,
and
they swapped her out with Kelly Marie Tran.
And while it is our 59th animated feature, it is our very first to be produced at home. Over 400 different homes at that. And from our homes to yours. As Kareem mentioned earlier, Raya and the Last Dragon will be released both in theaters throughout the US and around the world, as well as on Disney Plus with Premiere Access. This simultaneous release on Disney Plus and in theaters March 5th gives audiences every possible opportunity to see the film. In Disney Plus, we have a home for our legacy of films, upcoming films like Raya and the Last Dragon, and we see boundless creative opportunities to continue stories
Disney
with
animation
our favorite
proper
characters,
outside of Pixar,
as well
has
as
been
create
killing
original
it lately.
Stories set in all new worlds, working with talent not just in our studio, but around the world. Today, we're happy to announce several new projects in development and production. This is where nostalgia meets the future. We begin with Disney Animation's first ever animated series. It takes place in one of our favorite fantastical cities
Big Hero
and
6.
Stars one of our most beloved characters. To tell you more is the Oscar-winning director of Big Hero 6 and creator of Baymax the series,
I love Big
Don
Hero
Hall.
6.
Hey everybody, I'm Don Hall, director of Big Hero 6. I am so excited to talk to you about Baymax the series for Disney Plus. The series is a continuation of the movie. We actually get to explore more of the city of San Francisco. This huge, wonderful, rich
I love
canvas.
This movie.
The series really focuses on Baymax's original protocol, which is to be a nurse robot. Each episode, we meet a new character, a patient that Baymax is going to help. I would like to be more like Baymax. His kindness, his compassion, his single-minded devotion to just helping people. He's kind of a hero for the times. And lastly, I don't want to give away any spoilers, but Baymax will have a new feature that will allow him to quickly travel around the streets of San Francisco looking for patients. Thank you, everybody. We're very excited to show you more.
I'd be far more
Baymax
interested
will be on Disney Plus in early
Big Hero 6, the series, than just a Baymax series.
Also in production.
Yeah, whatever.
Welcome back to the mammal metropolis of Zootopia.
Oh, you knew they'd go back to Zootopia.
Directors Trent Corey and Josie Trinidad are creating a short-form series called Zootopia Plus. Zootopia Plus takes a hilarious look at some of the animals we only briefly met in the Oscar-winning film, including Frou Frou, gazelles, tiger dancers, and our favorite sloth, Flash. We'll get insight into their lives through the lens of Zootopia's hottest shows, like The Real Mousewives of Little Rodentia, So You Think You Can Prance, and a show that follows the fast lane of life at sloth speed. Zootopia Plus is set for Disney Plus in spring 2022.
All right, more interested in this than I am in the Baymax show.
Cinderella, Ariel, Elsa, Jasmine, Rapunzel. Disney Animation has brought some of the greatest heroines to the screen. Characters that people connect with and who stand the test of time. And with Disney Plus, we're creating new stories for these characters, starting with a favorite, from New Orleans, Princess Tiana.
I heard they were going to go back
to
that.
We are bringing Tiana and her friends back for all new stories in a long-form musical comedy series. The possibilities are endless, with Tiana stepping into a role as
Princess
of
the Frog was underrated. It's actually a really good little film.
So much more of New Orleans yet to see. Tiana comes to Disney Plus in 2023.
Okay, I'm on board.
There's another series we're excited to announce. One that focuses on a heroine who asks herself how far she'll go.
I love Moana.
Yes, we are developing a long-form musical comedy series exploring new stories with Moana. There is such a deep love for this character in this film, and that love has only grown in the years since the film's initial release. In the series, Moana's boundless sense of adventure and skills at wayfinding take her far beyond the reef. Since our first research trips to the region for the film, we continue to be inspired by the deep oral storytelling traditions of the Pacific Islands. And to help tell the stories for this new series, we are connecting with talent from the region. Moana the series will be on Disney Plus in 2023.
Love it. I love that movie.
There is one more series I am thrilled to announce today. An all-new, all-original series created in a whole new way for our studio. Back in the beginning of 2019, I saw a news piece about a group of storytellers and artists from Nigeria and Uganda. The title of this video was Pan-African Comic Book Hopes to Kick Disney's You Know What. I was intrigued. Here were three talented comic book artists. Tolu Olofoyeku, Zeke Nelson, and Hamid Ibrahim founded an entertainment company called Hugali. Their dream was to bring African stories created by African artists to the world. Through comics and animation, highlighting the diversity of cultures, history, and voices across the continent. Their talents as storytellers blew us away. I'm proud to announce a first-of-its-kind collaboration as Hugali and Disney Animation team up to bring their original long-form series to Disney+. The series is called Iwaju, which in the Yoruba language roughly translates to the future. Set in Lagos, Nigeria, and steeped in science fiction, Iwaju explores deep themes of class, innocence, and challenging the status quo. Iwaju will debut on Disney Plus in 2022.
It's got a Wakandan feel to it a little bit.
As you can see, we're embracing the opportunities Disney Plus provides. We cannot wait to share more in the coming months. But today, I want to leave you with a very special project. Our animated feature film set to release fall of 2021. We've not officially announced this movie until today. For our 60th feature, magical realism sets the stage. And yes, it is a musical stage.
Of course.
As we travel to Colombia, where a magical family, the Madrigals, live in an equally magical home.
Madrigals.
Our film is called Encanto. Why? Because Encanto is a charmed place, born of its unique wonders, where life itself is wondrous. Directors Byron Howard and Jared Bush, the filmmaking team that brought you the Academy Award-winning Zootopia, are joined by co-director and co-writer Charisse Castro-Smith, and bringing his talents as both songwriter and story collaborator is the incomparable Lin-Manuel Miranda.
who worked with them on Moana.
It's hard to believe it's been 4 years since we first heard his incredible music in Moana. And we are so excited to re-team with him for Encanto.
Nice. I'll tell you what, they have been... Disney Animation has been killing it lately. Like, it has for a while became about Pixar. And instead of Disney Animation, it was all about Pixar doing everything great. And Disney Animation put out some stuff. But Disney Animation has been kicking ass a lot lately. You know what? Let's get, while we've got a minute left to go here. We've got a minute and 10 seconds. Let's do some questions here quick from you guys. Let's see. Pixelated Apollo writes, I am scared that Disney will control streaming. Hey, listen, as long as Netflix, by the way, is still triple the size of Disney Plus. So there's Netflix, Amazon is killing it, and wait till they get their Lord of the Rings series. HBO Max is really good. I mean, we're kind of joking about HBO Max crapping their pants right now, but HBO Max is really good. So I wouldn't worry about that. Boston McClellan writes, why go back to Rebellion era with Rogue Squadron? I'm okay with that. I if they have new characters, new stories, if they do that, I'm fine. They've got a lot of other stuff. Like they've got the Rangers story that's going on, Rangers of the New Republic. We got the Ahsoka Tano. We got Mandalorian, all that stuff that's already moving forward in the storyline different ways. So I'm okay if they go back for one, especially if Patty Jenkins is doing it. Luis Nunez writes, will we get Spider-Man news? I believe we will. I believe we will get Spider-Man news today. I don't know 100% for sure, but I believe that we will. All right, let's get back over to it now and see what we've got next.
That's Encanto, a musical comedy with songs in Spanish and English that's not afraid to dig deep into the dangerously wonderful chaos of family. From Kumandra to Colombia, San Francisco to Zootopia, from New Orleans to the Pacific Islands,
you know, it's
to a
nice lineup
world in Africa.
That's a nice
the story
lineup.
Possibilities for the near century
not jumping
old
out of my skin
Disney
for
animation,
it, but that,
a more limitless
that up there
than
is
ever.
A nice lineup.
It is now my pleasure to introduce my esteemed colleague at our fellow animation studio, a person both tall in stature and in talent, from Pixar Animation Studios, Chief Creative Officer Pete Docter.
I love Pete Docter. All right, let's see what Pixar's got up.
Hey, everybody, I'm Pete Docter. Pixar started in 1986 with the dream to take the wonderful tradition of animation and transform it using state-of-the-art computer technology. Tradition and innovation.
He's already the best presenter they've had today. He's already the best one they've had all day.
Pixar since the very beginning. Since then, we've gone on to make 23 feature films and many, many shorts. And as a director of several of these films, it makes me so happy to hear that folks who grew up on these films as kids
look at that
are
lineup.
Now passing them along to kids of their own. It's hard to believe Pixar has been around 34 years, but you know what? Truth is, we're just getting started. Today, I'm excited to introduce you to a bunch of fresh new filmmakers. Getting their voices on the screen is our key focus right now, while at the same time allowing our veteran filmmakers to continue to mature and do their great work. And I think that's really what we do best at Pixar. We honor tradition while at the same time innovating for the future.
All right.
Here's something that sure took a lot of innovation. It's our 23rd feature film called Soul.
Oh, I'm so excited for this.
And it's one of the most challenging and rewarding projects I've ever directed, that's for sure. Soul is set in two distinct places, one that's familiar and one you've never seen before. The film looks into what makes us who we are and what we do with our limited time here on Earth. Appreciating the simple joys of life, finding the spark that makes you, you. The themes of Soul feel so timely to us right now that we're happy that this movie will be shared this year with audiences around the world.
I love that Pixar isn't afraid to get
metaphysical.
We're
excited to bring a little joy to everybody this holiday season. So let's take a look at what you'll see this Christmas on Disney Plus.
One, two, three, four, stay on the beat. Two, three, four. That's in sharp horns. Two, three, I see you, Caleb. Got it, go for it.
Thank you. Hang on. What are y'all laughing at? So Connie got
looks like my high school jazz
That's
band
a
class.
Good thing. Look, I remember one time my dad took me to this jazz club, and that's the last place I wanted to be. But then I see this guy, and he's playing these chords with force on it. And then with a minor, I was, whoa, whoa, whoa. Then he has the inner voices, and it's like he's singing. And I swear, the next thing I know, it's like he floats off the stage. That guy was lost in the music. He was in it, and he took the rest of us with him. That's when I knew I was born to play.
I'm in this already. I'm so into this already.
Look around. Life has so much to offer.
I'll watch this just for the music.
We only have a short time on this planet. Don't miss out on the joys of life. Remember to enjoy every minute of it.
Joey!
What has gotten into you,
Let
boy?
Let him finish.
Cougar.
Finish. Okay, I'm all about this. I can't wait to watch this.
Speaking of Disney Plus, we have a bunch of new projects we are making exclusively for the streaming service. Now, hopefully you've been able to check out some of our Spark Shorts.
Spark Shorts.
These
are
a collection of shorts made by a diverse group of new storytellers at Pixar. They've really struck a chord with many around the world. Our next Spark Short,
Float,
Burrow,
is awesome.
Follows
a
young
that.
Rabbit as she tries to build the home of her dreams. It's by first-time director Maddie Sharafian, and I'm excited to say it's going to be released on Disney Plus along with Soul this Christmas. We've also launched a new documentary series called Inside Pixar, which invites you into our studio for an up-close, never-before-seen look at the artistry, the craftsmanship,
I've been there.
And the storytellers
of
Pixar.
Place, Scott.
The first
Seriously,
five
is a magical
episodes
place.
Are available right now on Disney Plus, so check them out. And more are scheduled to be released in the coming months. Next, grab a quick snack with Pixar Popcorn. This collection of mini shorts feature your favorite Pixar characters in all new bite-sized stories created by Pixar animators. These were a blast to make. Pixar Popcorn comes to Disney Plus
this coming fitness and
January.
Beyond. See the one with
We also have
and beyond.
Three
okay.
all new series that you'll soon be seeing on Disney Plus. The first is near to my heart, as it's a spin-off from Up.
I love that.
Doug Days.
I love Doug.
It's written and directed by the hilarious Bob Peterson, the creator of Forky Asks a Question and the voice of Doug. This brand new series follows our favorite talking dog, now with Carl, as he returns from the dangers of the South American jungles to the dangers of suburbia. Here he will face many challenges, including puppies, fireworks, and of course, squirrel! Doug Days will premiere on Disney Plus in the fall of 2021.
Not going to lie, I'm going to watch
one
the
of
shit
our favorite
out of that.
Episodes.
Doug, could you watch him for a spell? I'll be right inside if you need me.
Oh, yes, oh, yes. I will take care of these puppies.
You might want to quiet
Why do I love
down.
This so much?
I want the puppies to wake up so that I may take care of the puppies.
You got your wish.
Puppies, puppies.
Okay, here they come.
I'm loving this. I'm a dog guy, so I'm loving this.
I am faster than you. I am faster than a puppy. Hello, puppies. It is me, Doug. Oh, puppies.
I'm eating this up. I'm not going to lie. I'm eating this up.
Ow. You are sharp teeth, you puppies. Tiny puppy teeth. Puppy teeth. Ow. Oh, so sharp. Now I'm feeling chewed. Otto cachorro. Hare tele show. Basta cuchore. Ow. Puppy teeth. Tiny puppy teeth on me. Now I am turning. Ow. Turning and hurting. It is kind of fun. Oh, fun and hurting.
Hang, hang, hang.
Next,
okay,
we're excited to reignite the Cars franchise with
really?
An all-new series
Cars
that
again.
Follows Lightning McQueen and his best friend Mater as they head on a road trip across the country.
They just won't
These
give up on Cars.
These episodes will be filled with lots of fun new characters, imaginative destinations,
Not their most successful
as well as
stuff.
Old friends checking in along the way. Our all-new Cars series is coming to Disney Plus in the fall of 2022. Following that, we're very excited to announce Pixar's first ever original long-form animated series. This is a big deal for us. It's being written and directed by two young story artists, Carrie Hobson and Michael Yates. While working together on Toy Story 4, these two often noticed that they'd have very different impressions of the very same meeting. One would think it went great, the other thought it was a disaster. And they thought, hey, that would be a cool thing to explore. And it developed into an original series we're calling Win or Lose. This series follows a co-ed middle school softball team in the week leading up to their championship game. Each 20-minute episode follows the same week, but from the perspective of a different character. But it's not really so much about softball as it is a comedy about love, rivalry, and the challenges we all face in our struggle to win at life. Win or Lose is coming exclusively to Disney Plus in the fall of 2023.
Hard to say how excited or not excited I am without seeing something from that.
Those are all projects we're working on for Disney Plus, all being made by our filmmakers in Emeryville with the same passion and excitement and quality as our feature films. And speaking of our feature films, we have an exciting lineup to share with you that really captures that perfect blend of tradition and innovation that I talked about earlier.
Feature films that'll still go to Disney Plus.
At the center of each of our big tentpole films is a deeply personal story, and our next feature is no exception. Luca is the first feature for director Enrico Casarosa, who made the short film La Luna. And it's a love letter to Enrico's home country of Italy, and a celebration of the universal themes of friendship. Set in a beautiful seaside town on the Italian Riviera, this original film is a heartfelt story about a young boy named Luca and his best friend Alberto, who experience an unforgettable summer filled with gelato, pasta, and endless scooter rides. Luca dives into theaters around the world in June 2021.
If there are
Here's a sneak peek at our all-new trailer.
Oh, okay. Okay, so they're going to go. Hey, you know, I'm Italian and I love that stuff. So we got about a minute here while they're on that. Let's get to some more questions you guys have been sending in. If he in Spider-Man 3, do you think they say if Charlie Cox joins Spider-Man? I mean, again, I don't know that I buy that rumor. It's certainly possible, but I haven't seen like Variety or the Hollywood Reporter or Deadline or like the real news outlets have not reported on that at all. So I have my doubts, but it's possible. And hey, there is a possibility if it's true, and I'm not sure it is, but if it is true, there is a good chance they might talk about that today. We'll find out. Jamie writes, John, any chance we see a young Luke Skywalker is played by Sebastian Stan in the Rogue Squadron movie? I doubt it. And I honestly don't know why people keep going on about this Sebastian Stan thing. Okay, I get it. He looks like a younger Mark Hamill. That's why you cast him? I don't know. But no, I doubt it. I don't think they'll go to Luke Skywalker. I think they'll move away from that. But anything's possible. Anything's possible. Let's see here. Trevelian85A2 writes, awesome stream, John. We need to see Star Wars, Disney. Yeah, this has been fun. I've been loving doing this. This has been way more fun than I thought. We've been going over 3 hours, and this has been great. All right. It looks like they're ready to come back. Let's jump back on over and see what Pixar has up next.
After Luca, I'm excited to announce two new films today, both releasing in 2022. In the spring of 22, we have an original film directed by another first-time feature director, Domi Shih, who won an Academy Award for her Pixar short film, Bao.
Bao is so great.
For Turning
Good
Red.
Good Canadian girl, by the way, too.
This is May, confident 13-year-old who's experiencing the excruciatingly awkwardness of being a teenager. Everything in her life is changing, her interests, her relationships, her body, balancing all this with family and crushes and her devotion to the biggest boy band on the planet is no small feat.
Awesome, absolutely awesome.
Oh, and one more little detail. Whenever she gets too excited, which for a 13-year-old is like always, she uncontrollably poofs into a giant red panda. Kind of like the Incredible Hulk, but cuter. Turning Red is an original take on the great tradition of coming-of-age comedies, albeit one with an emotional and a furry twist. And coming in the summer of 2022 is a science fiction adventure film unlike anything we've done before.
They're doing a spin-off.
At first glance, you might think,
spin-off.
This is a Toy Story film. Well, not so fast. See, back when we created the very first Toy Story, We designed Buzz Lightyear with the idea that he was a toy based on some really cool character from an epic blockbuster film. Well, all these years later, we decided it's time to make that film.
Oh, I'm on board.
Directed by Pixar vet Angus McLean, co-director of Finding Dory, Lightyear is the definitive origin story of the original Buzz Lightyear. And it reveals how this young test pilot became the space ranger we all know him to be today. And we're excited to announce this new Buzz Lightyear will be voiced by none other than Chris Evans.
Wow.
You don't get much more traditional Pixar than Buzz.
Not
we're
Tim,
excited
huh?
to have Chris's help in bringing a new twist to this iconic character.
Interesting.
We can't wait to take audiences to infinity and beyond
Keeping
as Lightyear
Chris Evans
launches
in the Disney
into
family.
Theaters in the summer of 2022. So there you have it. Pixar continues to transform.
Nice.
Even
Nicely
as we
done.
Become a proud part of the
that
wonderful tradition
That scene red sounds really
animation.
Interesting.
We look forward to introducing you to even more characters,
By the
old
way, I
and
love
new,
the fact
in years to come.
That Pixar... Just, we'll take young
just
filmmakers.
Don't tell Kevin Feige that we're give them Chris Evans away from Marvel Studios, okay? Oh no, here he comes!
Oh, and here comes Marvel Studios. Oh, here we go, guys! Here he goes. No time to talk about how good the Pixar thing
Thanks,
was.
Pete.
Get into
good
Marvel.
Good afternoon, everyone. We at Marvel Studios are thrilled to have a home on Disney Plus, where nearly the entire Marvel Cinematic Universe is laid out in a way that's easy for fans around the world to enjoy. And today, I'm excited to talk about the expansion and future of the MCU. As you may know, the cinematic universe weaves storylines and heroes and villains across 23 feature films to date.
Here we go.
And with Disney Plus, we're able to extend this way of storytelling to a new format, creating series that are connected to our theatrical releases, making the MCU more immersive than ever. There's a lot of new content coming from Marvel Studios, so let's get started. WandaVision will be the very first Marvel Studios series on
month.
Disney Plus.
Or next
Wanda
month.
And Vision are two of our most powerful and complex heroes, and this series is a perfect expansion point for MCU storytelling. Launching on Disney Plus on January 15th, here's a look at the brand new trailer for WandaVision.
Brand new trailer.
So what's a single gal like you doing rattling around this big house?
Well, I assure you, I'm married to a man, a human one.
Wanda. But it's rain, and I run.
We are an unusual couple.
Oh, I don't think that was ever in question.
We just don't know what to expect.
Howdy, neighbors.
Hey, bud.
Wanda, what's up? Who are you?
I don't know. Something's wrong here.
Wanda, can you read me? Who is doing this to you?
Are you here to help us?
This is awesome.
Home. Then let's fight for it.
Nice.
Well, I think we handled that well.
Nice, nice. That looked great. It looks psychedelic.
Elizabeth Olsen is currently in London right now. She's shooting the film Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness with director Sam Raimi, star Benedict Cumberbatch, and the rest of the cast, including Benedict Wong, Rachel McAdams, and Chiwetel
Ejiofor. We're going to talk about on the John Campbell
Show
tomorrow
them
is a about
new
Rachel McAdams
fan favorite
joining.
Character from the comics, America Chavez, played by Sochi Gomez. This film hits theaters March 25th, 2022, and we're really pushing the boundaries of storytelling with this thrilling, scary, mind-bending adventure. Not only will Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness connect directly to the events of WandaVision, but it will also connect to the events of our new Spider-Man film coming to theaters December 2021. Moving to our next series for Disney
if
Plus,
theaters are still
which
around.
Launches this coming March, The Falcon and the Winter Soldier
All
features
right.
two recognizable superheroes last seen together in the final moments of Avengers Endgame. Sam Wilson, aka The Falcon, is played by Anthony Mackie, and Bucky Barnes, the Winter Soldier, is played by Sebastian Stan. The Falcon and the Winter Soldier is a cinematic experience. It's a Marvel Studios movie played out over six episodes. And now here for the first time is an exclusive look at The Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
All right.
The legacy of that shield is complicated.
Upside down.
This is great.
People need something to get behind. They need a symbol.
So what's our plan?
Come on, show some more Zemo.
No plan.
Great.
I'm just all smiles right now. This is my most anticipated Disney Plus show. This is my, especially the MCU related. This is my number one most anticipated.
What's going on in that cyborg brain of yours?
You don't want to know.
Oh yeah, I can see it working. Gears turning. Oh, they're malfunctioning. They're on fire.
God, I hate you.
I'm very excited for this one. This is the one I am most looking forward to.
Now to another hero we last saw in Avengers Endgame, Black Widow will return to the big screen on May 7th, 2021. Of course, the film stars Scarlett Johansson.
All right, they're saying it's still theatrical.
Fans have been patient, and I can't tell you just how ready we are.
I thought they'd move to Disney Plus, but sounds like it's still theatrical.
And speaking of fan favorite characters, Loki. The God of Mischief will step out of his brother's shadow and into his own series on Disney Plus in May
of next
year.
This is my second most anticipated one.
The great Tom Hiddleston returns as Loki and is joined in the series by Owen Wilson, Gugumbatha Raw, Sofia DiMartino, Mumni Mosaku, and Richard E. Grant. As with our other shows coming to Disney Plus, we want to try something a little different, explore a new genre for us at Marvel Studios. So we've put Loki in the center of his own crime thriller. If that sounds a little unusual or confusing, don't worry. Loki is just as confused. Here's the very first look at Loki.
Oh, we're going to get a first look at it.
Get your hands
Tatooine. They're crossing over Marvel and Star Wars. All right, not much of a look, but it was something. Oh, it's not over. Okay, good.
You're taking me somewhere to kill me.
No, I'm taking you someplace to talk.
Where I lie, I don't like to talk.
But you do like to lie, which you just did. Because we both know you love to talk. Talky.
How long have you been here?
I don't know, it's hard to say. You know, time passes differently here in the TVA.
What does that mean?
You'll catch up.
Glorious.
Ha 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 ha. All right, that's not what I was expecting. That's different.
Come on. What did you expect?
All right, that's different than I thought it was going to look like. Why not? Okay, it's different.
Shifting to Marvel Studios' first animated series, coming to Disney Plus next summer, What If? Flips the script on the MCU, taking famous events from the films and reimagining them in unexpected ways. We've assembled a stellar voice cast with many MCU stars reprising their roles.
A lot of the originals.
Here's a look at What If.
They previewed this at D23 that I was at a while ago.
Space. Reality. It's more than a linear path. It's a prism of endless possibility.
Well, that doesn't sound ominous at all.
Oh, Galactus in there.
Promised an army.
Peggy becomes Captain America.
A super soldier.
Cool. You sure don't seem too freaked out about all this, kid. What you doing out there all by yourself anyway?
Exploring the world.
Sounds fun. But why stop at one world? When we can show you all of them.
I am the Watcher. I am your guide through these vast new realities. Follow me and dare to face the unknown. Ponder the question.
You know, I didn't like the idea of this series. I didn't like the idea of the series when they first... Wow. I didn't like the idea of the series when they first announced it, but then when I saw the preview at D23, it got me interested. That got me even more interested.
Australia on our film Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings. And we're so impressed the way Simu Liu has brought the character of Shang-Chi to life.
From Kim's Convenience.
Simu is surrounded on screen by a fantastic cast that includes Awkwafina, Tony Leung, and Michelle Yeoh. This
what
film is among the very first in our Phase 4 and is set to release in theaters on July 9th, 2021. Launching on Disney Plus later next year is Ms. Marvel. Ms. Marvel is a Pakistani-American teen superhero.
Played by a Canadian.
Earlier this year during shutdown, we held online auditions all around the world to find our Kamala Khan. And we found her in Iman Vellani. Iman will be surrounded by a phenomenal cast and creative team that will bring this story to life. So here's an early look at Ms. Marvel.
What?
Ms. Marvel is a new kind of superhero. But at the core of all of it, her story is so universal.
Ms. Marvel is one of the newer characters in the Marvel comics. And when one comes in that grabs the world's imagination like this, the questions are, when are we going to bring Ms. Marvel to the screen?
When Ms. Marvel first came out, we had such an incredible reaction.
It was so incredibly popular because everybody could see themselves in her.
I never saw a young teenager.
My wife loves this comic. Loves this comic. She's very excited for this.
Promise you'd be cool.
I am cool.
The casting process was vast. When we discovered Iman, we knew that she was Kamala Khan.
It was unanimous decision.
Yeah, I can't comprehend this right now.
And then, of course, we've got a really incredible team of directors. Bilal Fallah, Adel Al-Arabi, Mira Menon, and Sharmeen Obaid-Chinoy. And all of them are taking the material and elevating it.
So human. It's about a teenager figuring out who she is and about relationships. Family and friendship is at the heart of the MCU canon. That's what's so exciting about the story that we're bringing is that we're going to introduce you to a new family that's also going to be part of the wider MCU.
Very excited for this. Very excited for this. Nice. What's next?
A fact about Ms. Marvel is that her idol is Captain Marvel. And Captain Marvel 2 is currently in the works with director Nia DaCosta. And today I'm excited to announce that Ms. Marvel, played by Iman, will be joining Brie Larson and co-starring in Captain Marvel 2, along with a grown-up Monica Rambeau, played by Tiana Paris, whom we will have already met in the upcoming WandaVision.
WandaVision, yep.
So by now you should start getting a sense of the interconnectedness that infuses all of our storytelling.
Always has.
But that doesn't mean there aren't some unexplored corners of the universe. With next year's Eternals, we're introducing a brand new ensemble of superheroes to the MCU, played by a spectacular cast. This is an epic story spanning thousands of years, and it's one of our most ambitious films yet. It's set for theatrical release on November 5th, 2021.
With a suddenly ripped Kumail Nanjiani.
Original Avenger Jeremy Renner returns to star in Hawkeye, launching on Disney Plus late next year. In our series, Hawkeye teams up with another well-known archer from Marvel Comics, Kate Bishop. And I'm very pleased to confirm that Kate will be played by the amazing Hailee Steinfeld.
Rounding out that cast
are Vera Farmiga, Fra Fee, and newcomer Alakwa Cox playing Maya Lopez. The episodes are being directed by Rhys Thomas and the directing duo of Bert and Birdie. Debuting for the first time in the MCU, She-Hulk is coming to Disney Plus. It's a series about a woman trying to navigate the world and be taken seriously as a working professional, despite the fact that she's well over 6'7" and green. It's a very funny series being directed by Kat Coiro and Anu Valia. And I can officially confirm that She-Hulk / Jennifer Walters will be played by the talented and Emmy Award-winning Tatiana Maslany.
Yeah, some people
I'm
trying to say she wasn't.
I'm also pleased to reveal that the brilliant Tim Roth is returning as the Abomination.
Yes!
The character we first introduced to the
yes!
MCU in 2008.
Yes, I knew they would bring that character back sometime. I knew
but
they would bring him back.
I can confirm that the Hulk himself, Mark Ruffalo, will be appearing in the series as well.
Nice.
And since Jennifer Walters is a lawyer who specializes specifically in superhero-oriented legal cases, you never know what Marvel characters are going to pop up from episode to episode. Bringing a whole new different vibe to the MCU, Moon Knight
Rob will be excited
is an action-adventure, Indiana Jones-type story coming to life as a Disney Plus series directed by Mohamed Diab. The character Moon Knight is a complex vigilante who suffers from dissociative identity disorder. And these multiple identities that live inside him are very
Rob's
distinct
so
characters in
this.
The series. The backdrop of our story is incredible Egyptian iconography. Egyptology is something the world's always been fascinated by, and we're going to tap into it in a fun and bold way in Moon Knight. Now I want to talk about a couple of projects that we haven't announced yet. The first of which is Secret Invasion, coming to Disney+. Samuel L. Jackson is back as Nick Fury, and Ben Mendelsohn from Captain Marvel returns as the Skrull.
Nice!
Next
so I guess
Civil
that's
War,
the Nick Fury show
Secret
they were
Invasion
talking about.
Is arguably the biggest crossover comic event in the last 20 years, and we're bringing it to Disney+. It's about a sect of Skrulls who have infiltrated every level of life on Earth. Ironheart will be a series for Disney Plus about genius inventor Riri Williams, who has the most advanced suit of armor since Iron Man's. Dominique Thorne will play the title role. And as we like to do, both Secret Invasion and Ironheart will tie directly to MCU feature films. We're also well underway on a series for Disney Plus based on Armor Wars, a classic Marvel story about Tony Stark's worst fear coming true. It's what happens when his tech falls into the wrong hands. And this series will star beloved member of the MCU, Don Cheadle, will be
they
returning as Jim
Cheadle's
Rhodes,
show.
AKA War Machine. One of the best things about expanding the MCU to Disney Plus is that our team at Marvel Studios is finally able to do some of the things we've always wanted to do, but didn't quite have the right outlet for.
You're kidding
like
me.
Like produce our first ever live action holiday special.
Oh my
In Reverent Guardians fashion, the Guardians of the Galaxy Holiday Special is going to be
funny.
A lot of fun, especially since James Gunn is back to write and direct. In fact, we're going to shoot it during production of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. This special will drop the holiday prior to the next Guardians of the Galaxy film, which hits theaters in 2023.
Crazy.
And speaking of Guardians, aptly titled I Am Groot, everyone's favorite little tree, Baby Groot, will star in a series of shorts on Disney Plus featuring several new and unusual characters. Before I go, I couldn't leave you without giving a few more updates on some of our most anticipated upcoming films. In January, we'll begin filming Thor, Love and Thunder with director Taika Waititi and Chris Hemsworth, Natalie Portman and Tessa Thompson returning. And I'm pleased to confirm that Academy Award-winning actor Christian Bale is playing the villain, Gore the God Butcher.
He is
playing Thor, Love and Thunder releases in theaters on May 6, 2022. As we announced at Comic-Con last year, we're moving ahead with Blade, starring Academy Award winner Mahershala Ali. The development and storylines are coming together, and we'll have announcements very, very soon.
Okay, so still nothing.
Director
official.
Peyton Reed is hard at work with our Marvel Studios team on the third Ant-Man film, which will officially be called Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. Paul Rudd, Evangeline Lilly, Michael Douglas, and Michelle Pfeiffer
They're
are all returning. And Catherine Newton is joining the cast and playing Cassie Lang. And in the role of Kang the Conqueror,
he is
we have a great
Kang.
Actor,
it's
Jonathan
confirmed.
Majors.
There it is.
I wanted to acknowledge the devastating loss of a dear friend and member of the Marvel Studios family. Chadwick Boseman was an immensely talented actor and an inspirational individual who affected all of our lives professionally and personally. His portrayal of T'Challa the Black Panther is iconic and transcends any iteration of the character in any other medium from Marvel's past. And it's for that reason that we will not recast the character.
They're not going
to
do it.
To honor the legacy that Chad helped us build through his portrayal of the King of Wakanda, we want to continue to explore the world of Wakanda.
I'm surprised.
And all of the rich and varied characters introduced in the first film. Writer-director Ryan Coogler is hard at work on the sequel now and will bring the film to you in theaters July 8th, 2022. And finally, I'm happy to announce a film about one of the truly iconic Marvel families. In fact, Marvel's first family.
They're going to talk Fantastic Four.
We're working on a feature now, and it will be directed by the director of our recent Spider-Man films, John Watts.
Wow.
We've got a lot in store at Marvel Studios, and Disney Plus is key to the interconnection and expansion of the
Guys,
MCU.
Guys, where do we even start
with
this tomorrow show?
It will be home for both our feature films and our series for years and years to come. Since Marvel first joined Disney back in 2009, Bob Iger's been the biggest champion of the work that we do. None of this would have been possible without his support. So it is now my pleasure to turn things back over to Bob. Thank you.
Wow. Okay, we're going to hang with Bob here for
a
little bit.
What an amazing presentation by Kevin and all of our creative executives. Truly astounding. As you just saw for yourselves, the same attributes that define our theatrical releases, the grand scale and scope, stunning artistry, and groundbreaking special effects are also apparent in many of the series we are producing. Of course, as remarkable as that presentation was, we obviously didn't have time to show you everything coming to Disney
Plus.
No, you
did not.
Particularly a lot more original Disney-branded content. We launched the service last year with great ambition and high expectations, and we've exceeded them by every measure.
All right, now they're getting back into business
stuff. There are
thousands
of episodes of television and hundreds of library
titles guys,
and theatrical releases.
Well, I would love to hear more about what Bob has to say. We're running out of time here, and now they've covered everything. I want to take... Listen, tomorrow on the John Campia Show, obviously tomorrow morning, 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, we are going to unpack all of this. I don't even know how we're going to cram all this into 2 hours tomorrow, but make sure you come back for the John Campia Show tomorrow. We're going to spend the last couple of minutes that we have here, guys, going over questions that you guys have sent in. Oh my, they just announced that they're not going to recast Black Panther. I think that's a mistake, but I'm sure they're going to handle it really, really well. Whatever way they're going to do it, I'm sure they're going to handle it super well. I mean, oh my God, they finally announced Fantastic Four. We got our director for Fantastic Four. I really thought Peyton Reed would direct it. So much stuff to unpack. Make sure you come back and join us for the John Campia Show tomorrow. Now let's go over and start taking some of the live questions you guys have been sending in before we sign off here after this almost, we've been going for 3.5 hours now. Joshua Tabak writes, no way Disney Plus remains $7.72 after all this. No, they've already announced that they're going to bump up the price. We all knew the price was going to go up, and really for all we're getting, they could double the price and it would still be well worth it, to be honest with you. Ben Rivera writes, what voice do they use for Vader in Obi-Wan? That's a good question. Maybe they still, I mean, I don't know. I mean, listen, there have been a lot of different guys who've done the voice of Vader in different video game iterations at times that are often pretty good. So that's a good question. We'll see what they do. 24 Savage writes, chances of a Family Guy film happens. I think pretty good, but probably not until after they're done their TV series run. Silimidios writes, it seems Lucasfilm is having a creative boom while Disney proper is still creatively broke, scrimmaging around for IPs to hastily soullessly reboot. And I gotta tell you, that's the one part of this whole presentation that I wasn't super impressed with, which was the Disney films proper, although there were a couple of things in there that look kind of interesting. Not super great. Like almost everything else really exceeded expectations. Mary writes, it's midnight here and I'm overloaded, wide awake. I cannot believe how much stuff they just dropped. I mean, it's insane how much they just dropped. Angel Palma writes, I didn't know Ice Age was now under Disney. It was under Fox, It at some point got under Fox, and now that was part of the IP purchase and all there, if I'm not mistaken. Mary writes, John, you're the mother effing goat for streaming this. Hey, it's been a lot. I've loved doing this. This has been a lot of fun. Thank you guys for joining me on this. A Comic Quirks with Jimmy writes, they didn't talk about National Treasure 3. I'm mad. Well, remember, it's still really, they've been talking about how that project is still alive. They're still trying to get it going, but they have not confirmed that it's happening or anything like that. So it may be another year or two. It may never happen at all, but don't become too discouraged about because they didn't talk about it today. Don't be just too discouraged by that. Yeah, just hang in there. Ryan Bernstein writes, will Premier Access still be $30? I certainly hope not. That's a ripoff of a price, especially when it's just going to come on Disney Plus a few months later. So I hope they do some adjustments with that. Alejandro Angel. And by the way, I wish they had addressed that in this stream. I do wish they had addressed that in the stream. Let's see. Alejandro writes, the dragon from Raya reminds me of the one from Neverending Story. That's what I thought last year when I saw it at D23 as well. Tiberius Monk 84 writes, great stream tonight, John. Well done. Thank you so much. It's been a lot of fun doing this with you guys. Temple Gal writes, with Patty Jenkins taking over Rogue Squadron. What do you think our odds of seeing Luke Skywalker and Wedge high, Luke low? That's just a guess. I obviously don't know, but my guess is high chance we have Wedge Antilles in there, low chance that we see Luke Skywalker. That's just my guess right now at that. Marie Seifring writes, I'm so excited about what I've seen so far. I don't even know how we're going to begin to unpack all this tomorrow on the show. I don't even know how. High writes, hello from Oxford, UK. I watch many live streams, but I must say you have one of the best and funniest audience. I have a great audience. You guys have been awesome. Thank you so much for being here. And really, bravo to Disney for this presentation. It has been gangbusters, absolute gangbusters. Let's see. I just got a text from Robert Meyer Burnett. It said, brah, biggest mic drop in entertainment history. He's not wrong. Josh A writes, now he's back. Yay. Bringing in Hayden in Ahsoka series. CW flashbacks could be a rad way to contextualize her role in the saga for new viewers. That is also, like, they specifically said it was going to be for Obi-Wan, but understanding the connection between the two characters, having him pop up in an Ahsoka show could work quite well. Jared McCowan just sends in a super chat. Thank you so much. Mary writes, good luck organizing your show tomorrow. I don't even know where we start. Like, tomorrow's show is going to have to be like 4 hours long. I don't even know where we're going to start tomorrow, Mary. Joss A writes, the only era Lucasfilm isn't servicing is the sequels. LOL. Well, I think we're going to see more. I think Taika and other projects you're going to see get more past that. It's time to move past the sequels as well. All right. Mike Thompson writes, between Soul and Wonder Woman 84, I'm going to have one hell of a double feature on Christmas. Absolutely. Also, if you must be thrilled about the Ahsoka series, listen, everybody knows I don't like the Ahsoka Tano character. Everybody knows that. But even I really liked what they did with her in Mandalorian with the great Rosario Dawson playing her. So even I, the guy that doesn't like Ahsoka Tano, even I am looking forward to seeing what they do with this. What the hell does that say? That says a lot. That even I am looking forward to that. Dear God, what kind of world? Up is down, cats and dogs living together. It's kind of crazy. Shizwan writes, apologies, you've talked about this, but thoughts on AT&T selling Crunchyroll to Sony Funimation? Why do that instead of incorporating Crunchyroll's library into HBO Max, especially since they got Ghibli? Today we really want to focus on the Disney stuff and what they're doing, but it is a fascinating development. I think it looks like Sony is trying to evolve an overall streaming strategy, and we're just seeing the first pieces of it right now. So, yeah, I mean, look, obviously HBO didn't see a lot of value in what the Crunchyroll thing was. Sony does. So let's see how this kind of evolves. And but again, I think we are just seeing mere fragments and pieces of what Sony's overall strategy is going to be. Adam writes, with all the rumors and announcements about Spider-Man, I feel Marvel are missing one key feature, the 1970s live action show Spider-Man. God, do you guys remember that? If you guys haven't seen any of the live action Spider-Man stuff from the 70s, go look it up on YouTube if you want a good laugh. Matthew Cassidy writes, Hera Syndulla in Rogue Squadron. I'd be down for that. Hera Syndulla is, of course, a character from Rebels. It is my favorite Dave Filoni character. that Dave Filoni has kind of brought to us. I think she is just like the best character out there. In all the expanded Star Wars stuff, I would love to see that. Like, I don't know if the timeline is going to fit up with wherever they're going to put this for sure, but I would absolutely love to see that, Matthew. Mike Thompson writes, do you think they'll bring out a Sony rep and announce that Spunk is officially, unequivocally part of the MCU? Well, clearly they didn't do that. So that was sent in about 20 minutes ago. Clearly they didn't do that. I am surprised they didn't really talk much about Spider-Man or any of the casting stuff. I thought they would, but they didn't. So there you go. Joss A writes, holy F, that Falcon tracking shot looked great, didn't it? So much. I just so looking forward to that damn thing. Eric Benson writes, Disney, just take all of my money, all of it. Dude, what they have rolled out today. I have been critical of Disney's Disney Plus for over a year now that they really haven't given us any premium content. They gave us one season of Mandalorian before the second season started, and all they gave us was Hamilton. Everything else has kind of been filler content. And I've been critical. Holy crap. Holy crap balls. They are about to change that in a big way. Tom, Jemavir writes, you better keep this stream up. This stream's still going. Luke Dennis writes, so what's going to theaters only? Like they said a number of things. Like Kevin Feige said, coming to theaters this date, coming to theaters that date, but I don't even know if the theaters are still going to be around. And are they going to do theaters only? Like, Raya and the Last Dragon is going to be Disney Plus Premier Access and theaters. They didn't say Disney Premier Plus with Black Widow. And I thought they were going to announce Black Widow just going straight to Disney Plus, period. They're still saying theatrical in March. Let's see if they actually hold to that. We'll see. Great Bondi writes, no Deadpool 3 on the list. Surprise. No, they're still a ways off from doing that. They're still a ways off. So I'm not surprised at this point. War Machine rocks. Don Cheadle's got his own show. When shall we see the fox catchers at Disney parks? Go meet Mickey, Minnie, Homer Simpson, the Predator. The Predator. Wouldn't that be something? C. Rapier Copeland writes, do you think they changed course on Black Widow to Disney Plus because of bad press from Warner Brothers 2021 moves to HBO Max? No. Disney does not. Oh, by the way. Oh, they're talking about some pricing stuff on Disney Plus right now. They moved up to like £9 euros in Europe. Anyway, Disney does not react to what other people are doing. Disney sets a plan and they stick with it. So they have clearly always, we're going to keep. Contrary to what I thought they were going to do, I thought they were going to move Black Widow to Disney Plus. I've been saying for a couple of weeks now, I mean, they could move it. They could keep it in theaters. That's possible, blah, blah, blah. But I really believe, not that I knew, I just believed, I really believe they were going to put it there and they're not. So no, this wasn't them reacting to the HBO thing. That's not what Disney does. Rudy R.A. writes, still holding out that Charlie Cox's Daredevil will show up in Spider-Man 3. Again, don't believe it. Listen, whenever you get rumors like this starting on non-major news outlets, keep it in the back of your mind, but don't buy into it yet. If it's real, then the real news sites like Variety, The Hollywood Reporter, Entertainment Weekly, Deadline, they will report on it if it's real, eventually. So the Charlie Cox thing, I haven't even talked about or made a topic on my show because why is it the major trades aren't talking about it? That doesn't mean it's not true, but it means there's not compelling evidence to believe that it is true yet. So if it is true, eventually the real news sources, the real news sites will report on it and then we'll talk about it. But, you know, 15 to 20 of these types of rumors come up every day and you got to be careful what you get excited about. Maybe it will. Who knows? Maybe it will. Samuel Shin writes, as a diehard Fantastic Four fan, I can die happy knowing that at least I'll get a decent Fantastic Four film and a proper Doctor Doom, please. Yeah, now, they didn't tell us anything about it. Of course, as soon as we saw that Kevin Feige was about to talk about Fantastic Four, we were wondering, are you going to mention John Krasinski and Emily Blunt? That's all of us, right? They didn't, so let's see what happens. They still didn't even say when. They said they're just starting to work on something. So this could be still like 4 years away, but at least we know they're working on it, and that's exciting to hear. Andres Moran writes, have you read Ready Player 2 yet? I loved it. I have not, but I am excited about it because I loved the movie Ready Player 1. I never read Ready Player 1, but I will check out Ready Player 2 because I like the movie so much. Brendan Shee writes, I really thought John Krasinski, Emily Blunt was going to be the last stinger in Kevin Feige's presentation. That would have been the cherry on top. Here's the reality. They're not going to cast this movie until they at least got a script or they know what they're going to do with this movie. Because who knows? Maybe they're going to do a certain thing with this movie and John Krasinski and Emily Blunt would be a terrible fit for it, right? If they do the movie a different way, maybe they'll be a perfect fit for it. So I'm not surprised that they didn't, but I wouldn't have been surprised if they did announce them. That would have made the internet explode. All right, last couple of questions here, guys, and we got to call it a day. Clifford Fawcett writes, I think the presentation was created prior to the recent Spider-Man casting knowledge drops. Maybe yes, maybe no, but I don't think, again, Disney does not change their plans or change what they were going to do either way. But you could, you know what, this was clearly all pre-produced. So you could be very, very, it is very, very likely that you're right about that, Clifford. Absolutely. Scott Brooks writes, why did Disney give an international solution for Fox movies on Disney Plus with Star, but nothing for the US? Again, I'm not convinced that they didn't, but we'll find out more about that. Because remember, they also have Hulu. They have Hulu, which can be an outlet for all that stuff. But I want to get a bit more clarification about how Star is going to integrate into Disney Plus in North America, if it is, and we'll see how that all kind of works out. Right now, I think that's still a little bit unclear. Jonathan Cortez writes, I had a nergasm with all the Star Wars stuff they showed, as well as with Marvel. Alien series, baby, by Noah Hawley. Like, coming up, that is crazy. Of course, he was behind the Legion TV series, which he did such a great job on that. It's amazing. I've not been excited about an Aliens franchise for a while, and now I am again. All right. Cullen Prime writes, Fantastic Four announcement and Ruffalo appearing in She-Hulk had me cheering at the top of my lungs. You know what? I was more excited about Abomination. I've always said at some point they will bring that Abomination back. They will absolutely bring that Abomination back. They will. And they did. And I'm thrilled Mark Ruffalo's coming back. Don't get me wrong. But I'm even more excited about Tim coming back as Abomination. All right, guys, listen, I got to have you send in. No, don't send in any more super chats. I got to just rip through these because I've got to jump off here really fast. Let's see here. James Argento writes, wouldn't make more sense for She-Hulk to show up in Spider-Man 3 than Daredevil if Peter needed a lawyer? Yes, that would make far more logical sense. And by the way, nobody has said that Daredevil's going to show up in it. No official source, no legitimate news site at this point. That doesn't mean it's not true. I'm just saying there's no reason to give it too much thought quite yet, but we'll find out. But yeah, it would make a lot more sense for her to be a lawyer if he needs a lawyer in it. Lady Russ. Ruskaline writes, I think Charlie Cox's Daredevil will show up on She-Hulk. Kevin was literally winking at the camera. Not so sure about that. I'm not so sure about that. But yeah, again, you never know. You never know. Wakandan Forever writes, Black Panther 2, no recast of Chadwick Boseman, King T'Challa, tears in my eyes. I lost it, but I trust Disney. Iwaju, those are our cousins. Wakanda Forever. Listen, I got to say, I think it's the wrong move. I think it is a mistake to not recast T'Challa. I think it is a mistake not to have somebody come and pick up the baton for Chadwick Boseman and carry on the character in his honor and in his name. I think that is a mistake. But I trust Disney. I trust Kevin Feige with what they're going to do with Marvel. I trust that Ryan Coogler is going to do something that honors and respects it and still makes it good. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. I do think it's a mistake. But I trust they're going to do a great job with it either way. Darth Wayne writes, guess no Boba series, huh? Just because they didn't announce it today doesn't mean they won't have something planned for later. Or just maybe they're going to intend to have him wrapped up more in the Mandalorian series. And Chris Cooper just sends in a super chat. Thank you for that, Chris. And guys, that'll wrap up for me for this. What a fucking day. What a fucking day. I knew they were going to drop some big stuff. And they still have the thing going, talking about content expense and what they're projecting for 2024 and all this kind of stuff and what their revenue is going to be and good on them. But we got to sign off here. I knew they're going to drop some big stuff. I was not prepared for how much glory and goodness they were going to drop. That has been crazy. Guys, we're going to have a lot to talk about on tomorrow's John Campia Show. Make sure you come back and join us for that 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time tomorrow. Me and Robert Meyer Burnett will be here. In the meantime, guys, if you haven't done so already, go ahead and click on the subscribe button, become a subscriber to the channel, keep up to date. We, for those of you who are new around here, we do a 2-hour daily show talking about all of our favorite things in the world of movies, movie news, streaming, television, a lot of Disney Disney Plus stuff to unpack tomorrow. Make sure you come back and join us. Again, thank you to all you guys for joining me here on this today. This has been a lot of fun. My name is John Campion, my friends. And until next time, everybody, stay smart, stay safe, take care of yourselves. Please take care of the people around you. And until tomorrow, my friends, bye-bye.